Tonight, Bethune Cookman and its Speedway offense invades. Tonight, Bethune Cookman and its Speedway offense invades Wally's world, where conference player of the year candidate Chris Wally is steering Norfolk State toward its first MEAC title. Will it be full steam ahead, or will the Wildcats find a way to sink the Spartans?
Welcome to the USS Enterprise.
Bethune Cookman is taking on Norfolk State next.
On ESPNU.
You are watching ESPNU College Football Primetime presented by McDonald's. We're the great naval town of Norfolk, Virginia. And when it comes to Admiral of the MEAC this season, that has been Norfolk State. First place in the conference, just one loss on the season. Winners of five straight. They have their sights set on their first MEAC championship. Last year, the team to beat in the conference, of course, was Bethune-Cookman, their opponent tonight, with Jay Walker, former Howard quarterback, Ibanez Schroff, and Jay Bethune-Cookman. It's been a different season. Last year at this time, we're talking about them potentially running the table. They've had some bumps in the roads and some ups and downs this season.
Yeah, and right now, the defending champions have their backs up against the ropes. I believe that they must win every single game remain on their schedule if they want to have an opportunity to get invited to the FCS playoffs.
Meanwhile, Norfolk State, they've been the darlings of the conference this year. The great story has been their quarterback, Chris Wally, one of the best in the FCS.
Yeah, and what do the coaches do? They call him a coach on the field. Chris Wally's having a phenomenal season. You show me a quarterback with numbers like that, and I'll show you a quarterback that's leading his team in victories.
He rarely gets sacked, but that's not going to stop Bethune-Cookman from coming after him. And the Wildcats have a player to do that on their front line in Ryan Davis.
Yeah, when you're a team that really prides yourself on applying pressure to the opposing team's quarterback, it all starts with the defensive line. And Ryan Davis is one of the best defensive linemen in the country. 12 tackles for losses on the season, 5.5 sacks. He's very active for this very aggressive Wildcat defense.
The head coach for the Wildcats is Brian Jenkins in his second season. Last year, he led Bethune-Cookman to its first playoff appearance since 2003. And over on the other sideline, Pete Adrian in his seventh season as Norfolk State head coach, an alum of West Virginia, and the MEAC Coach of the Year in 2007. His team has not lost to an FCS opponent this season.
What a fantastic job Pete Adrian's done with this Norfolk State team. Highest ranking in school history, being ranked number 2 in black college football. Quite an accomplishment.
Bethune-Cookman will kick off. Norfolk State will receive here at home on a Thursday night. The Spartans looking to stay unbeaten in the MEAC as they try to continue on in their quest for their first MEAC conference title. Victor Hairston across the 30-yard line. And he gets to about the 33-yard line, and we get our first look at this Norfolk State offense led by Chris Wally. Wally's world, they like to say here in Norfolk, Virginia. And we talked about it off the top. He is one of the best quarterbacks, not only in the conference, but in all the FCS.
Yeah, you see the 11 touchdowns, but more importantly, only 2 interceptions on the season. Doesn't get hit a lot because he has a very quick release, makes the most out of his pre-snap read to figure out what the opposing defenses are trying to do to him.
A run on first down. Takeem Hedgman finds a seam, and he takes a few tacklers to about the 40-yard line, a gain of 5 yards. Impact players for Bethune-Cookman, Reggie Sandilands, part of a very good linebacking core for Brian Jenkins Wildcats.
And we talked about Ryan Davis on the defensive line in the open, but when you see Reggie Sandilands, number 11, when you find the football, more than likely you're going to find Mr. Sandilands somewhere in the vicinity.
Hedgman again makes a nice cut. And he's close to a first down, finally taken down by Ryan Lewis. And it is a first down for Norfolk State.
Good job of establishing control of the line of scrimmage by Norfolk State right away. You saw Bethune-Cookman on second down try and go to a 4-man defensive line to move Sandilands on the line of scrimmage to try and stop the running game. couldn't do it right away. If Bethune can continue to have that type of success running the football, it'll be a long day for the Wildcat defense.
Four wide here on first down. Wally, first pass of the game. It's Xavier Boyce. Eludes one tackler, and he got back to the line of scrimmage. No gain. That's the Virginia Tech transfer, Xavier Boyce.
And this is the matchup I want to see, because Norfolk State doesn't have a vertical passing game. They rely on these wide receiver screens. I don't know too many teams in the country that can outrun Bethune-Cookman's defense. Sideline to sideline, they're very aggressive. That's the matchup we've got to watch tonight.
Empty backfield here on second and 10. Wally gets rid of it. That's Victor Hairston across midfield and into Bethune-Cookman territory. 14 yards and a first down for the Spartans.
Great job by Wiley, the recognition. You're going to see them bring a zone blitz to the outside. Go to the open man, get a wide receiver, outflank on the linebacker, and allow him to run after catch to pick up the first down.
Norfolk State, they know how to strike early. They've scored on their first possession in each of their first seven games of the season. In Wildcat territory, first and 10. Wally under pressure, and that's a rarity. He's sacked. Cornelius Wheeler and Ryan Davis got to him.
You want to try and get to the pressure. If you can get there with the four-man rush, defensive coordinators really like that one. That's just a sandwich there. Poor job up front by the offensive tackles for the Norfolk State.
And that's only the eighth time all season that Ryan Wally has been sacked. That tells you just how good the line has been and how quickly he gets rid of the ball. Wally under pressure again. There's a flag on the play. Throws on the run downfield, and it's incomplete. They wanted Kelvin Lewis, but there is a penalty marker back at the 44-yard line. Donnell Leathers is the head referee.
Personal foul. Face mask. Number 48 in defense. 15 yards. Automatic first down.
Cornelius Wheeler on the face mask penalty for Bethune.
Now, if Norfolk State's going to go to five wide receivers, and they're going to have to come up with an answer for Ryan Davis, the defensive end. Watch him just get shot out of a cannon and disrupt the backfield. Number 49 right here. That's going to be a problem all night long if they cannot solidify that matchup, giving Bethune-Cookman the ability to flush your quarterback out of the pocket. When you've got five blockers and they've only got four rushers, look out.
They catch a break, though, first down after the penalty. This is Hedgman across the 40, and he ran right into Ryan Davis.
Ryan Davis is just active. We've seen him on pass rush. Now watch this. Read, recognize, shed him off your body, and have the ability to keep your head upfield in a visionary position where you can attack the running back once he has the football.
Loss of two on the play, so it'll bring up second and about 11 and a half, 12 yards here. Wally with time, under pressure, and it's Davis again. That's not a good sign for Norfolk State. We've called Ryan Davis's name quite a bit on this first drive.
Yeah, you know, you got to get him some help right now. You've got a tackle that's shown he cannot block him. It looks like a grown man going against a high school offensive tackle at that position. So you're going to have to do some things to chip to get somebody over there. When a defensive lineman comes in with 12 tackles for loss, then you might want to give him that respect and say, let's get him some help, maybe move a tight end over there. Kendall Noble's really struggling right now to block Ryan Davis.
And he's their best lineman. Second team MEAC last year, the only returning starter up front for Norfolk State. Wally throws, and over the head of Xavier Boyce, his intended receiver.
for number three.
We talked about the 71% completion percentage of Chris Wiley. Well, this is how you get that percentage down. Get pressure, hit the quarterback. A quarterback that cannot set his feet and step into his throw tends to be an inaccurate quarterback.
So Troy Munzer on to punt it away. Preston Cleckley back deep for Bethune Cookman. And this is the first time in seven games that Norfolk State didn't score on its opening drive. Cleckley signals fair catch, makes it at the 12-yard line. That's where Bethune Cookman will start. When we come back, scoreless with 10:32 to go, but there is a flag at the end of the play. Stay here for now. Officials huddling up. Saw Cleckley signal for a fair catch.
Personal foul. Receiving team, number 27, at the distance. First down.
So that's Daniel Rhodes called for the personal foul, and Bethune Cookman will be backed up, but they'll have the ball when we come back.
The Mid-Eastern
United States.
I don't know about you, but I walked away from there more impressed with our servicemen and the jobs they do. That was quite impressive, that aircraft carrier.
Bethune Cookman will start at the 6-yard line. It's Jackie Wilson, the quarterback for the Wildcats. Brian Jenkins waited until right before the game to name his quarterback, and he's done that a few times this season.
It puts a quarterback in a tough predicament, but you got to make the most of the opportunity.
This is Isidore Jackson on first down, and he picks up 4 yards. Corwin Hammond made the tackle. Impact player for Bethune Cookman, it's the Rutgers transfer, J. Eddie Poole.
And Eddie Poole's a big-time deep threat. Transfer from Rutgers. You know, one thing about him, and I talked to the coaching staff for Norfolk State before the game, they say Eddie Poole, he runs deep, and he runs deep well. Doesn't catch too many underneath passes, so look for Bethune to really try and neutralize his downfield catching abilities. If he's going to have success tonight, it's going to have to be with those underneath routes.
Jackson right up the gut again. And he gets three more. Josh Turner on the stop, and he's our impact player for the Spartans.
And quite simply, Josh Turner is unblockable, not just on this level of football, but they took on West Virginia earlier in the year. West Virginia had a hard time blocking this defensive tackle.
Pete Adrian, their head coach, to Josh Turner. He's a guy with next level potential. 6'1", 315, clogs the middle in that 3-4 defense. Low snap, Wilson throws long, and it's hauled in by Maurice Francois on the near sideline, marked out of bounds at the 39-yard line, a gain of 28 yards.
A great throw by Wilson. This is where you want to put this ball. Ball snap low, but look at the trajectory on this ball, right over the outside shoulder. That's one where you tell the running back, you just run downfield 20 yards, look over your right shoulder, and I'm going to put it on the money.
This is Jackson. He's across the 40. Nice burst of speed. And a gain of 8 yards. And Jackson close to a first down for Bethune Cookman.
Jackson's a guy that they like to really use. They say he's a great blocker, but he's got that burst. Once he gets past the initial line of scrimmage, to shift and make you miss the first time.
Wildcats are on that no-huddle offense. They like to move quickly. Keep it on the ground again, and it's Jackson, and he's got a first down, and Bethune Cookman into Norfolk State territory.
When you watch these two teams, don't they seem kind of similar? Very aggressive defensive, spread offense, like to have the quarterbacks control the game. They marry each other, and it's ironic because for many years, Pete Adrian built his name as a coach down at Bethune Cookman. Coached at Cookman for a number of years, helped build that program, taking to success, and now he's doing the same here at Norfolk.
Wilson. Over the middle, Francois. He's inside the 30-yard line. Tackled by Devontae Reynolds, but not before a 20-yard gain.
This is a great job of just playing with the free safety. You see the free safety in the middle of your screen. You saw him freeze him in the middle of the field, giving him the ability to stick the seam route in there to Francois.
Bethune Cookman bringing two tight ends here on first down. This is Jackson. Nice cut. And he's down to the 20-yard line. Gain of 7 yards. Corwin Hammond with his second tackle.
Good job by the Wildcats. They throw the football right when they start to establish control in the passing game. Then they sneak Jackson in there to run hard behind that left side. Terrence Hackney and Jackie Hoffman doing a good job on the left side of the Wildcat offensive line.
Once more on the ground, and it's Jackson moving the pile. Isidore Jackson picks up 4. Good enough for a Bethune Cookman first down, and they're now in the red zone.
And although they haven't shown it just yet, the moment you start to focus on Jackson, Jackie Wilson's a pretty mobile quarterback as well. He can really hurt you with his legs. Good sign for Bethune Cookman when they're able to run the football. Really does open up the playbook. Then you've got Eddie Poole you can bring in there for the deep throw into the end zone and also roll out your quarterback from the pocket.
Another run, and Isidore Jackson getting a heavy workload as he gets to the 15-yard line. And let's take a look at what Bethune-Cookman has done in the red zone this season, brought to you by Verizon. 29 drives, 22 scores, 19 touchdowns, 3 field goals. This is Jackie Wilson running the option there, the little read option, and he goes up the middle for a gain of 5. It'll bring up 3rd down.
Something that we mentioned when we were talking is the fact that Norfolk State plays a true 3-4 defense. Mm-hmm. And the key to attacking a 3-4 defense is run to the bubble. When they've got a bubble with an uncovered guard, that's the weakness of that defense, and Bethune-Cookman seems to have success right now running to the bubble.
11th play of the drive. Once more, Isidore Jackson hops over the 5-yard line, but a flag at the end of the play.
Personal foul. Face mask on the defense, number 26. Half the distance, first down.
That's the senior, Ricardo Volson.
You see there on the cut by Jackson on the inside. Volson grabbed a little bit of that face mask to move the Wildcats a little bit closer to the goal line. Look at this. 8 runs and only 2 passes, and they're just muscling the ball down the field on the Spartans.
Anthony Jordan comes in, and he's tripped up by Terrence Pugh.
In the game versus West Virginia, West Virginia had the ball on the 2-yard line. Norfolk State kept them out of the end zone on 6 consecutive plays. This is a defense that when they do decide to get out of the 3-4 look and go with a pure goal line front, very difficult to score on them.
Pete Adrian, a lot of confidence in the D. He called it the best defense in the MEAC. 2nd and goal. This might be a free play. Jackie Wilson goes into the end zone, but hang on, a flag. Actually, Bethune may have jumped here.
False start on the offense, number 85, 5 yards, 3rd and 2nd down.
That's the backup tight end, Gene Dessen. Third penalty of the game for Brian Jenkins' Wildcats. They average more than 10 per game on the season.
I think that's always a surprising statistic. As much of a disciplinarian as Coach Jenkins is, for his team to get the number of penalties that they get in every football contest is kind of surprising.
Wilson rolls out, throws, and the ball was deflected, incomplete. So a big third down coming up. Terrence Pugh got his paws on it.
You saw the half roll by Wilson here. Not a very well thrown. If you're going to roll out to the left, you've got to find a throwing lane. You just can't throw through people. Pugh didn't even have to jump, didn't have to leave his feet. Ball hit him right in the face mask.
Counts as a pass defense, though, right? Looks good in the stat sheet. They say in baseball, line drive in the box score. 14th play of the drive here on third and goal.
Eddie Poole's up here at the top of your screen.
Wilson throwing for the end zone. And a flag. Nat Turner Harris covering Eddie Poole, and they look to have gotten him.
That's the matchup they like to go to. You got Poole, the tallest wide receiver for Bethune Cookman. Plenty of contact. You can't push the wide receiver that far down the field.
And Turner, or Nat Turner, is one of the bigger DBs for Norfolk State. He's 6'1", 195.
That should be a good matchup to watch as the night progresses.
Anthony Jordan up the middle and into the end zone. Touchdown, Bethune Cookman.
Guys from Florida came in here to Norfolk and took control of the line of scrimmage early, pounded the ball on the Spartan defense, and Jordan able to capitalize and cap off the drive with a touchdown plunge.
Point after is good, and Bethune-Cookman, a 14-play, 88-yard drive. They've got a 7-0 lead with 4:08 to play here in the first. An Anthony Jordan 2-yard touchdown run capped a 14-play, 88-yard drive for Bethune-Cookman. And the visitors have a 7-0 lead with 4:08 to play in the first. We remind you, ESPNU's coverage of college football continues Saturday with a pair of games. The All-State Game of the Week comes your way at 3:30 Eastern. NC State against Virginia. UVA knocked off then unbeaten Georgia Tech last weekend. And then at 7 Eastern, it's Army taking on Vanderbilt. Strong words by James Franklin after the Commodores lost to Georgia. Little scuffle, I guess you can call it, between Franklin and Georgia defensive coordinator Todd Grantham after the game. And Franklin's message essentially was, we're not taking anything from anybody.
He's trying to say it's a new era in Nashville football. Vanderbilt for so long been on the bottom of that SEC pile. And if you're trying to rise up from the top, first thing you have to do is make your opponent respect you. They don't have to like you, but you want them to respect you.
Bethune-Cookman, they were respected last year. 10-1 in the regular season, got to the playoffs, but it's Norfolk State this year, unbeaten in the FCS entering this game. As Marcus Cooperwood will give the Spartans pretty good starting field position. Norfolk State down 7-0. Can they find a way to block Ryan Davis? He was a menace on the Spartans' first drive.
A full slate of college football games kicks off Saturday at noon on the U.
When you're looking for a twist, crack open a Bud Light Lime.
It's a fraction of the whole, but it's hard to control.
The great taste of Bud Light with a twist. Bud Light Lime. All the refreshment of Bud Light with a splash of 100% natural lime flavor. Bud Light Lime. It's Bud Light with a twist.
I love playing football because of the sense of unity that you can have amongst your teammates. And you're all working towards one goal. It's the ultimate team sport. Going out in Atlanta and seeing the people who aren't as privileged as we are and aren't able to play this great game that I play really makes me appreciate the fact that I'm able to go out there and represent Georgia Tech on the football field.
The emotional burden of debt. Not everybody can understand it. The worry, the endless collection calls. We know what it's like to be in your shoes. We're the providers of Care One.
Entering play, Norfolk State had outscored opponents 67-13 in the first quarter of games this season. Down 7-0 here. The Spartans couldn't do much on the first drive because of Ryan Davis.
Ryan Davis is being very active on that first drive, establishing that he's the best football player on the field, making the tackle for a loss, getting the sack on the quarterback, reading and recognizing and disrupting the offensive tempo for Norfolk State. And this is just a good bull rush right here to get the quarterback sack.
Okay, so what does Norfolk State have to do to adjust to make sure he can't be disruptive?
Well, I think on the second drive, you go out there and you try and challenge your left tackle to go out there and do a better job in terms of keeping him off your quarterback and Kendall Noble. But if not, then you've got to throw out your game plan and you've got to put an extra tight end in the game, which they don't like to do.
Bethune showing blitz, quick release, and that's complete to Kelvin Lewis. Gain of 2 yards. It'll bring up second and 8.
That's going to be tough. I mean, this is one of the fastest defenses in the MEAC conference. You know, like we like to say, the speed in Florida should never be questioned or challenged. And it looks like Norfolk State's going to try and challenge them with the horizontal passing game, sideline to sideline.
And their offense, Bethune, is known as the Speedway offense. Defense, that's a roadrunner too. Wally under pressure, chased. Wally's going to run it, and he's shoved out of bounds, chased by Jameel Farrington. He does pick up 4, though, third down coming up.
You know, it all starts from the outside. You see Davis is going to drop into coverage this time, and that way they send big Jameel Farrington to get pressure coming right up the middle, number 90 in your screen. Good job beating his man off the line of scrimmage, but just didn't have enough foot speed to chase down Wally.
Empty backfield here on 3rd and 5.
Bethune Cookman crowding the line of scrimmage, giving a look like they're getting ready to bring everybody. Nobody deeper than 5 yards from the line of scrimmage for Bethune Cookman right now.
Here's the pressure, quick release, and it is complete, but short of the first down. So 4th down coming up for Norfolk State.
And that's what you want to do if you're Bethune Cookman. You give the look like you're bringing all the pressure, force the quarterback to audible, and then when they do blitz, if he throws the ball short, you've won that battle.
So Norfolk State forced to punt for the 2nd time. Troy Munzer's kick. Out of bounds. Let's see where the officials spot it. Jay Walker's new to social media. We're not, though. We ask you on Twitter who should be the MEAC coach of the year. You can get in on the conversation by tweeting us at ESPNU. Certainly the man on the Norfolk State sidelines, Pete Adrian, has a strong case. 6-1, that one loss to West Virginia, an FBS team. And how about the job that Rod Broadway has done in his first season as head coach at North Carolina A&T?
That seems to be the talk between Pete Adrian and Rob Broadway. But look at Norfolk State, won 6 games a season ago all year, and they've already got 6 victories on the year this year.
Isidore Jackson broke free on the outside before being pushed out of bounds by Marcus Center. 14 yards, and Jackson having a terrific first quarter.
I mean, they have the ability to run the football. Zone blocking scheme, poor tackling by Norfolk State, and good downfield block by Eddie Poole. I'm very surprised that Bethune-Cookman has had the ability to run the football on this Spartan defense the way they have thus far.
Jackson, 9 rushes, 51 yards so far in the game. He gets it again. No, that's Jackie Wilson who'll keep it. And he got maybe a yard, 2nd down.
And they faked him out because actually Wilson made a poor decision with the football.
Should have ran it, right?
I mean, Shaq should have given it to the go man, Isidore Jackson. Jackson ran upfield for probably 10 yards untouched. From the 49.
There's a completion, and it is Patrick Harris on the catch for a gain of 6 yards. It'll bring up third down.
Let's go back to that previous play when the poor decision by Wilson pulling the ball out. See, once that defensive lineman has you in his grasp right there, should have given the ball to the running back right up the gap. That could have been a big play, possibly a touchdown run from Jackson. Mental error by the quarterback of pulling the ball out of the stomach of the running back.
Bethune Cookman's run 17 plays, 13 have been run plays. Low snap. Jackson dropped the football. It's ruled incomplete. Fourth down.
Wildcats showed the pressure. Man-to-man coverage across the board, forcing the Wildcats to settle for a swing pass, and they couldn't convert. So the Spartans get their first stop on the evening.
So Corey Kowalski on a punt for the first time. Marcus Cooperwood, the deep man. Flag on the play, line drive kick. It takes a Bethune Cookman bounce. And it goes out of bounds at the 9-yard line, but there is a penalty.
Yes, they brought him all the way up from Florida. You think Bethune realized their season's at stake?
Illegal formation. The offense, number 68, down on the line, 5 yards at the end of the kick.
Yeah, that's Alex Monroe lining up, making that formation illegal, in man on the line of scrimmage. But how impressive is that? The fact that Bethune Cookman travels that band all the way from Daytona Beach, Florida, here to Norfolk, Virginia. We're not talking about, it's easier to travel the football team than it is the band. Football team, you travel 63, they travel 400 plus a niche.
And I know you're impressed with the amount of tubas in their band. I remember you did that Prairie View Bethune-Cookman game, and you're impressed with the number of tubas that Bethune-Cookman has in its band. Is that sort of like a bragging card, if you will?
You know, it depends on what type of music you like, and I think it's the sousaphone slash tubas that bring the bass in the place.
Okay.
You know, if you want a little bass, you have to have that big booming sound of that tuba.
I was not a music guy growing up, didn't play an instrument.
Well, you're a piccolo type guy, Nish.
I don't even know what that is. Takeem Hedgman has some room, man. He gets close to the 30-yard line, a 13-yard run on first down. Head coach Pete Adrian saying he's waiting for Hedgman to have that breakout game.
I mean, this is a running back that averages 5 yards a carry, but he doesn't have the touchdown productivity to go along with that. Only 2 touchdown rushes on the year. You've got a guy that can average 5 yards a carry. He's got that home run hitting ability. He's got to figure out a way to take it to the end zone more often.
We've reached the end of one quarter here in Norfolk State. It's Bethune Cookman with a 7-0 lead after one.
Two of the neat.
And Norfolk State held scoreless in the first quarter for the first time this season. Chris Wally will try to change that here in the second quarter. Let's take a look at where I'm from, brought to you by the U.S. Marines. Norfolk State quarterback Chris Wally went to North Florida Christian High School. He was the Class 1A Player of the Year in 2006. And his high school coach, former Florida State quarterback Casey Weldon, who actually was runner-up in the Heisman Trophy voting the year our very own Desmond Howard won it all. And I know, Jay, you played with Casey.
Casey was a teammate of mine, and I played for the Barcelona Dragons. Dragons.
That's how they said it in Spain?
Dragons. Use the term teammate loosely. You know, only one quarterback gets to play. So I should say, should have said more like a competitor of mine, but Casey's a great guy.
There's that jet sweep. And a nice pickup by Kelvin Lewis. 14 yards and a first down for Norfolk State.
If you're going to run this jet sweep, you've got to seal the right side of the offensive line. A great job of blocking by Victor Harrison, number 23, sealing his man on the edge on the perimeter, allowing a running lane.
Hairston now in the backfield. Wally fakes it to him, chased by Davis. Throws on the run. And it is ruled incomplete. Boyce looked like he made the catch, but he didn't appear to be in bounds.
And it's going to be tough for Chris Wally to find some type of offensive rhythm in this ball game. I mean, his pocket's not there. Every time he drops back to pass, they're flushing him out of the pocket. And they're doing it, you know, by committee. You know, you got the nose tackle, Jameel Farrington getting pressure right up the gut. Then you've got Ryan Davis bringing pressure from the edge. And we haven't even talked about two of their better football players on this defense, and Ryan Lewis and Reggie Sandilands too often.
On the ground, Hedgman gobbled up in the backfield.
Now that
front four, Bethune is controlling this game so far.
Now this is the Bethune-Cookman defense that everybody got used to seeing and what you expected. You know, you got a defensive line that's stout, linebackers that can seek and destroy the football. The strength of the Wildcat defense is clearly in their front seven. And you don't believe me, just ask the University of Miami. They tried to push around this Wildcat defense with no success. Miami was forced to use the deep pass in order to put points on the board.
Yeah, you look at the final score of that game, you see 45-14. It was close for three quarters.
And they were right there into it. Miami had a little bit too much team speed on the perimeter to attack the secondary of Bethune-Cookman.
And a whistle blows this play dead here on third down.
Delay of game, offense, number 5-yard penalty, still third down.
Now one of these teams is playing like they're 6-1.
Mm-hmm.
It doesn't seem to be the team that has a 6-1 record. I think Bethune-Cookman realized that their season was on the line. Every game from now on is must win. And they're bringing intensity and fire right now to the Spartans.
At Norfolk State, this is a team 6-1 on the season, but that one loss was to an FBS team in West Virginia, a game the Spartans led at halftime. Wally throws, and is it intercepted? Was he in bounds? He's out of bounds. Gene Fenor showed some nice hands nonetheless.
I mean, good job. He was all over the route, the read, and the recognition, but not 2 yards out of bounds.
He's along that near sideline, sealed off by the standing Spartans from our view. 4th and 15. And Norfolk State will punt it away for the third time this evening. That one hops on Menzer. Takes a bounce at the 39. And Norfolk State will down it inside the 30-yard line. Bethune-Cookman football when we come back. It has been a quarterback carousel for the Wildcats. We'll fill you in.
Looks so good.
Jackie Wilson found out just before the game he would be Bethune-Cookman's starting quarterback for tonight's game. And part of the reason Bethune-Cookman was so successful a year ago, their quarterback Matt Johnson was the MEAC Offensive Player of the Year. This year, even with Wilson starting tonight, it has been a revolving door at quarterback.
Yeah, one thing about Matt Johnson, he was a winner. They thought they had the problem figured out when Jamar Robinson, the Must Ballyhoo transfer from the University of Maryland, stepped on campus. But that transition has not been as smooth as they would have liked, so they've been going with quarterback by committee. And they're really not counting on the quarterback to win the game. You can tell tonight they came out, it's not in Jackie Wilson's hands. They're putting it in the hands of the subsequent players, the offensive line, the running backs, trying to make it a little bit easier on the quarterbacks.
Rodney Scott, the Ole Miss transfer, has some room, and he's got a first down. So Scott picks up 14 on his first carry of the game.
Rodney Scott's a guy they like. He really catches the ball well off the backfield. He's very shifty. You're talking about a guy that played running back at Ole Miss in the SEC. He knows a thing or two about running the football. And from day one, once he stepped on campus in Daytona, they thought he was going to be an impact player. He hasn't proved them wrong.
Wilson, play action to Francois. And he fights his way to midfield. Nice pickup on first down. It'll bring up second and two, a gain of eight.
Once you've got the running game working, then you can go ahead and use a play action, turn your back to the defense, and get that head around, square up, and see Francois right there. You talk about Francois, he's a guy that was a former quarterback at Bethune Cookman, has made a nice adjustment going over to the wide receiver position.
Francois lined up in the slot here on second and short. This is Jackson. Can't get out of the backfield, but a flag at the end of the play.
For the Cats. A stop by Corey.
Holding on the offense. Number 68. 10 yard penalty. Decline. Third down.
So Norfolk State declining that penalty, electing to force Bethune-Cookman to maybe throw the ball here on third down.
Yeah, that's what you do. Instead of third and long, or instead of giving them second down, you know, you want to eliminate the number of chances they have to get the first down. So I agree with Coach Adrian and staff. You turned down that penalty because of the big play that was made by your defense.
Wilson to throw. Here's the pressure. And it's incomplete. Fourth down.
I like the defensive aggressiveness by Pete Adrian, really challenging his defensive secondary. When Bethune-Cookman has the ball in obvious passing situations, they're going straight man-to-man coverage.
Adrian told us yesterday that his defense is built for the spread. He runs the 3-4, but they're also familiar playing against the spread. Every team they've played this season has run the spread.
You see it over and over enough, and you start to develop the tendencies and what it takes to beat it.
Victor Hairston from inside his own 15, and he's trying to fight his way to the 20-yard line. He'll be shy of the 20. 42-yard punt, 5-yard return, and it'll be Norfolk State football. When we come back, the Spartans still looking for the first points of the game. Undefeated in the MEAC, but down 7 at home. Give kudos to the crew and Officer Sarah Kyler for showing us around, giving us the red carpet treatment, really.
What was your favorite part about the tour?
I had a few. I liked when they took us into the area where they build things, and they build things from scratch. If a part breaks on the ship, since that ship was built, what, 60 years ago?
Yeah, 50. 50 years ago.
You can't just order a part. You have to actually make a new one, and they basically make it. They give them a piece of steel and go ahead, make me a new one. First and 10, Norfolk State ball from their own 20. Here's Hedgman, and he pushes up to the 25-yard line. Jameel Farrington brought him down. Second and 5.
It's around this point in the football contest where the coaches start to make their adjustments to see what they think they can have some success doing. And for Norfolk State, teams, if they're going to try and go mano-a-mano versus Ryan Davis, for Bethune-Cookman, the defensive end on the left side of the ball, but look for them to try and maybe run at him as opposed to trying to run away from him.
While he throws, Boyce goes up to haul it in. Gain of 3 yards. It'll bring up third down.
So this is what you do when you've got a guy that's really giving you pressure. Then you slide the offensive line towards him. So you see that Davis thinks he's going to get a free look to the outside. But no, they move the whole offensive line to the left. Slide protection. That's how you slow down that pass rush.
Going with the Wildcat here on third down. Hedgman right up the middle, and he looks to have the first down.
Yeah, but every yard that this Spartan offense is getting, they're having to work hard for it. They're having to earn every yard. The Bethune Cookman's defense is being very stout up front and really controlling the tempo of this football contest. 71% passer just hasn't looked comfortable on the night. Possibly the offensive player of the year in the MEAC Conference. If you talk about Wally, he's been gone back for 9 passes, been sacked twice, knocked down 3 times, and hurried 4 times.
And that's Hedgman again. Got maybe a yard, second down and 9. Our Twitter question of the night, who should win the MEAC Coach of the Year Award? We've got one person saying Broadway's your coach of the year.
Come on.
Buddy from South Carolina State?
I don't even think Buddy Pugh thinks he should be up for coach of the year this year. I mean, that was a team that at one point was the number one ranked team in black college. They've gotten beat. We got some homers out there, Niche. Broadway, I can't argue with. Got a good point.
Pete Adrian's got a good case in Norfolk State.
Got a good case. I can't say for Buddy Pugh this year, and I think he may agree with me. I mean, there's been some great coaching. And the MEAC Conference as a whole has really got some fantastic coaches. We'll talk about that a little later.
Wally completes, and Kelvin Lewis lit up. Tim Burke, the sophomore, gets him for a loss.
I mean, very tough to beat a team with this much defensive speed. You see Ryan Lewis there to force the early throw, then Tim Burke to pay it off. This is Ryan Lewis, your preseason defensive player of the year, number 15, and Tim Burke making the receiver play.
The short passes clearly haven't worked for Norfolk State so far, so what's plan B?
You got to attack them vertically. I think that's what Miami was able to do, and Norfolk State has a deep threat. They just got to go to them, and they've tried to get the ball to him right there, and Xavier Boyce, the transfer from Virginia Tech. But you see the body English right there by Boyce. He's frustrated. The most frustrated person in the stadium right now is probably Chris Wally, because a 71% passer doesn't miss that wide open throw there. He just missed, but that's what pressure will do to you.
Now, Wally came into this game second in the FCS in completion percentage. Talking to Pete Adrian, his head coach, he said that he might have the best quarterback in the FCS. Maybe a little hyperbole there, but certainly he's been one of the best. Good kick by Menzer. Cleckley retrieves it inside his own 20. Now across the 25 and spun down near the 30-yard line. Bethune-Cookman ball when we come back with about MEAC news and notes coming up when we come back.
A full slate of college football games kicks off Saturday at noon on the U.
We're good at tailgating, but to be great, well, you need a little coaching.
That's where I come in.
Coach, are we running super cold activation today?
Always, Gary. Only Coors Light tells you when your beer goes from cold to super cold.
Frost brewed on 3. 1, 2, 3.
Frost brewed.
Ice down those Coors Lights, baby.
Ice. When it comes to big refreshment, we could all use a little coaching.
Nice crossing pattern, Randy.
We're tailgating at the next level.
Don't do it. Don't you do it.
Frost brewed Coors Light, the game's most refreshing beer.
A little help, guys.
If I were cheese, I wouldn't want to let go of myself either. Come try the cheese-inspired dishes on our 2-4-6-8 value menu, only at Denny's.
Many men have a small problem. When they get close to attractive women, they lose all self-control. Thankfully, there is a solution. Perspiration can be controlled.
Finallyfast.com saved my computer. It was so slow, virtually useless. I was this close to tossing it. Then I tried finallyfast.com and it fixed the problem. I got my speed and my sanity back.
If your computer runs slow, freezes, or gives error messages, get answers now with a free diagnosis at finallyfast.com.
A virus forced me to throw away a perfectly good computer. Now I keep it safe with finallyfast.com.
Take the next step to a faster, safer computer. Go to finallyfast.com.
As a former military police officer, I know the importance of computer security. That's why I trust finallyfast.com to protect my PC.
The very minute I ran finallyfast, I saw an improvement in speed.
finallyfast can diagnose your computer and get it running at peak performance, whether it's older or brand new.
finallyfast.
finallyfast.
finallyfast.com.
Get your free diagnosis now at finallyfast.com.
Pete Adrian's Norfolk State Spartans down 7-0. They're unbeaten in the MEAC, unbeaten against FCS teams this season, but trailing in this one so far. Some MEAC news and notes. North Carolina A&T undefeated in the conference as well. They've been a resurgent team, won just one game last year. Mike Mayhew leads the conference in rushing yards per game. Jay, your eyes lit up. Your alma mater, Howard, third in the nation in defense.
We're an academic institution, Manish, but I guess we're also starting to play some football, too. When you got one of the best linebackers in Keith Pugh, he's solely responsible for that category.
And Norfolk State's defense, they're pretty good, too. They're fifth in the country, giving up less than 287 yards per game on the nose.
When you think about the fact that Mike Mayhew at North Carolina A&T, that's a recipe for Rod Broadway. That's why he's having the success they had. Give him a good running back in the defense and he can hurt you.
Rodney Scott's a good running back, and he gets across the 35-yard line, a gain of four on first down. Corwin Hammond on the stop. A lot of first-year coaches in the MEAC this year. At Howard, you got Gary Harrell, Henry Frazier at North Carolina Central. Five first-year coaches in the conference at all. Scott, nice burst of speed, and he gets what looks like a first down, a gain of 7 yards. Amici Anyago on the stop.
And one of the stories going into this game was the quarterback carousel at Bethune Cookman. I mean, wow, they have really taken the ball out of the hands of the quarterback, and they are really solely relying on just lining up, playing power football, and pushing around this Norfolk State defense with the running game.
They'll throw here. Wilson under pressure, and he won't get rid of it. Sacked by Terrence Pugh.
Pugh brought the pressure to him, but off of the play-action pass, you're going to see Eddie Poole come wide open. You see the play-action here to your right. Number three is going to be right there on the left side of your screen. Poole was in the curl zone. Don't understand why Wilson wasn't able to locate him.
Low snap, Wilson lost it, and he's going to have to just fall on it.
Can't blame this on the quarterback. Watch it go right to a shoestring and just stay there. Ball's on a shoestring. He's trying to move backwards to get away from the rush for that first step. Good job by Wilson with just being able to recover that low snap.
Loss of four on the play, so third and 16 now for Bethune Cookman, a passing down. Wilson, little screen pass, Rodney Scott breaks the first tackle, hurdles one defender, and he's still tackled for a loss, so fourth down in the punting unit on for the Wildcats.
Great balance shown by Scott. Scott was in the most vulnerable position a running back can be in. His back turned to the defense and the ball hanging in the air. Has the ability to stay on his feet after that first hit and not give up the football.
Short kick, it goes out of bounds at the 45-yard line. 5:46 to go here in the half. ESPNU gets you started early on Saturday with its Saturday morning tailgate. College game day built by the Home Depot comes your way at 9 a.m. Eastern, a special college football version of Sports Nation at 10 a.m., and then college football whip around at 11 a.m., the show that gets you the latest from all the game sites just prior to kickoff.
Woo! What a difference a night or a team makes.
They have been bottled up so far. Hedgman on first down, and he gets a couple. It'll bring up second down and 8.
Football starts in the trenches. If you can dominate your opponent on the offensive and defensive line, such as the Wildcats have tonight, that's what your end result is. 7-0 Wildcats.
Going into the season, offensive line was a concern for Norfolk State. They've been playing better than expected, but they've been dominated so far in the first half by Bethune Cookman. Wally to Hairston across midfield and into Wildcat territory. Gain of 6 yards. It'll bring up third and short.
And Hairston may be the guy that they decide to shift the game plan from. If the Wildcats are taking Xavier Boyce away from you, then go to Hairston, who plays that slot receiver on the other side. He's got 37 catches on the season, but 5 touchdowns. He can be a big time playmaker for you as well.
Third down out of the Wildcat. Edgman right up the middle, and Norfolk State with a first down.
Crucial time in this football contest too. You've got a little less than 5 minutes to go before halftime. You're playing at home. You've got a lot riding on it on national television, that number 2 ranking coming into the game. You want to put some points on the board before you get to halftime. So control the clock a little bit. Put your best drive together, and at the very least, walk away with a field goal if you can. But if you can tie this thing up right before the half, be a huge emotional boost for the Spartans.
Wally under pressure, and he sacked for the 3rd time. That's Reggie Sandilands.
They figured out they were using the slide protection, so they decided to start using their outside linebacker. Sandilands is going to come from this outside linebacker position. Line him up one-on-one with the running back trying to block him, and Takeem Hedgman. I'm taking Sandilands every time. Sandilands showing you why these coaches say he's got NFL-type ability.
Norfolk State had given up just 7 sacks entering tonight. That's in 7 games, but 3 in this game. Wally throws. It's caught by Boyce. And he may have a first down depending on the spot.
That was a football play. I mean, Wally's going to get hit. You're going to see Wally get hit here, but watch Boyce climb the ladder. Go up and get it. Give up your body and come down with this ball. That's the sacrifice that you want your 6'4" wide receiver to make. Climb the ladder and make the catch.
Wally under pressure again. He'll tuck it and run, and he gets 1 yard, 2nd down and 9.
Jarkevis Fields making the tackle there, but you can tell Wally's not feeling comfortable in that pocket, so he's not even staying around to go through his progressions. If he finds some daylight to escape to, took off running, that's not his forte.
First carry of the game for Randy Maines, who had a big game last week against Hampton, but Maines meets Ryan Davis. So 3rd down and 9 for Norfolk State, less than 3 minutes to play in this first half. Spartans under 100 yards of total offense here in the first half. Here's the pressure. Wally gets rid of it. Boyce can't hang on. Good coverage by Gene Fanor. And on 4th down, it's Troy Menzer on a punt.
You see right here, nowhere to go. Wide receiver screen. You get that close to the line of scrimmage, they're not going to give you that call.
And they will not attempt a punt. They'll go for the 50-yard field goal. They've got a kick. Who's got the leg? Everett Goldberg. And now a timeout by Bethune Cookman, which was playing for the punt.
And I think this is something when you talk to the coaching staff beforehand, Peter Adrian said, I've got a short place kicker and I've got a long place kicker. And Goldberg's got plenty of leg when in the contest early, he nailed a 53-yarder that they ended up calling back. And in this stadium, it's probably the windiest stadium in the MEAC Conference. The wind is always swirling about 15 miles an hour. You can get an extra 7 or 8 yards on a field goal try. And when you talk to coach, he said, hey, if I've got the wind behind my back, I will go for a 50-plus-yard field goal easily.
Bethune-Cookman calling timeout. They brought out their punting unit. They had a return man back deep. And then you see Everett Goldberg lining up for a 50-yard field goal. Goldberg on the season has only attempted 5 kicks, all of them from beyond 40 yards. He's 2 for 2 from 50 and beyond.
Distance won't be a problem.
No. Goldberg's kick is up and good with distance to spare.
Ride the jet stream right through the uprights.
Pete Adrian will take the points. Norfolk State on the board. Everett Goldberg with a 50-yarder. Spartans, though, still down 7-3.
When you jump, a poll is out. Who's number one and by how far? All that and Jason Seahorn, guys.
All right, thank you very much, Dari. A couple of games that he mentioned we're looking forward to this weekend. LSU home for Auburn. Wisconsin going to East Lansing to take on Michigan State. I think Badger fans a little upset that they were only sixth in the first BCS standings.
I mean, I think they've probably had one of the best starts to a season. They've been explosive out there.
Let me play devil's advocate for a minute, though.
I know what you're going to say, UNLV and the other. They can only beat the teams that are on the schedule. I mean, you want them to be football players and athletic directors? I think they're a very potent team. Nobody really wants to see them. I think, you know, I've said all along, Oklahoma has a right to be upset. I mean, they started off the season preseason number one, went to Florida State, knocked them out.
But they'll play Oklahoma State and LSU will play Alabama. So, in essence, you look at those as potential elimination games if both teams are unbeaten going into the game.
You do. But, you know, it'd be so much easier to be number one rather than number three, hoping.
Courtney Keith bobbled it, retrieves it at his own goal line. And he still manages to get close to the 20-yard line, but there is a flag at the tail end of the play. Donnell Leathers, the head referee. Let's see what the call is.
Doing the return. Number 81 on the return team. Holding. 10-yard penalty. First down.
Well, we remind you that Saturday night, boy, do we have some great football games for you with some Heisman contenders that you'll get to see. Landry Jones and third-ranked Oklahoma. Jay was just talking about him. Home for Texas Tech. Stanford and Andrew Luck taking on Washington. Some see that as a potential trap game for the Cardinal. Nice run on first down by Isidore Jackson. He gets 4 yards, second and six, as we come up on 2 minutes to play in the half.
That was a pretty important penalty right there. If you're Bethune-Cookman, now you've got to run the ball before you can go into your hurry-up, no-huddle type offense. And if you're Norfolk State, take a chance. Be aggressive. Possibly try and force Bethune-Cookman to a three and out, get the ball back, and add some more points on the scoreboard before you go into half.
The Spartans have all three timeouts. Jackson again on the ground, trying to get to the outside, but he's denied by Marcus Cooperwood. It'll bring up third down. And Norfolk State uses its first timeout with 1:29 to go in the half.
Watch this kickout block right here on the left. You see that big gap right there? Look at this lane. You should be able to pick up more yardage than Jackson did, but started running sideways, didn't get that forward lean, only picked up 1 or 2 yards, but what a great kickout block on the left side of that offensive line and running to that bubble, what I talked about earlier.
Jackson coming off the best game of his career, 150 yards and three touchdowns in a 58-30 win against Division II Fort Valley State. That win snapped a two-game losing streak for Bethune-Cookman. They lost to Miami. That's not Miami of Ohio. Miami. Coral Gables, Miami. In a game they were in for three quarters, and then a big letdown the following week, losing 22-3 to North Carolina A&T. A game that you and I saw last year, the blackout game, where Bethune-Cookman won 67-17.
What a difference a year makes.
Yeah.
That's what you talk about. When things are going your way, they were rolling. I mean, Bethune-Cookman was the darling of all of HBCU football a season ago. This year, they've had to go through their trials and tribulations, and they're very fortunate to have the record they have, because had it not been for that overturned call on fourth down, Hampton would have beaten them as well.
Flag before the play.
This is going to hurt. If this is the illegal substitution, like I think, or 12 men on the field coming off of a timeout, that's not going to make Pete Adrian very happy.
No. We only got 11.
We already got 11, guys.
We got 11.
We already got 11.
Well, you see Pete Adrian yelling from the sidelines, count them up. He's saying we only got 11.
There's no foul on the play for illegal substitution. There's no foul for illegal substitution. Please reset the game clock to 129. Reset the game clock to 129.
So it appears they got that 12th man off the field.
Yeah, because that would have been really detrimental had you given Bethune-Cookman the first down by way of the penalty. Make him go out there and earn it.
Two tight ends here on third down and four. And it's another run. And it's Jackson again. And he's got the first down, 6 yards. So Bethune-Cookman moves the chains, and the clock stops with 1:26 to play.
Start to wonder, how is Bethune-Cookman able to push around Josh Turner in the interior line play? They are just running the ball up the gut against this Spartan defense. Number nine, the number's been quiet all night. We haven't called his name.
Once more, Isidore Jackson to the 30-yard line. He's got nine more.
Yeah, take a look at Turner. You're going to see him just a step late. He's going to get off his block, beat his man, but right when he's reaching to get him, oh, Jackson, that blur goes by him. Just a step late tonight on those tackles.
Bethune-Cookman's got two timeouts, not using them, though. They'll keep it on the ground. And once more, it's Isidore Jackson who picks up a couple. Josh Turner that time made the tackle.
Let's see, and they're sending just two bodies off him, a little shield, and that time he was able to get the to make the tackle to bring them down, but not after Jackson had picked up the first down.
You surprised they're not going to the air here with less than a minute to play in the half and with two timeouts?
I think so, but considering where they had the ball in field position, they wanted to make sure they at least grabbed the first down first or two. Now they can look to try and exploit.
Wilson will tuck it and run, and he'll get out of bounds as he crosses the 45-yard line. 13 more yards and another first down for Bethune-Cookman.
This is one where they're going to try and open it up. They picked up the first down, as you mentioned. Now they're being aggressive, and this is something we haven't seen from Jackie Wilson tonight, the ability to run the football. You can tell he's got some athleticism there.
A run here, and it's Jackson, and he may have gotten back to the line of scrimmage. So it'll bring up second down, and Bethune-Cookman uses its second timeout to stop the clock here with 21 seconds. Now, unlike Norfolk State, Bethune-Cookman really doesn't have a ton of faith in the kicking game. Their kicker did hit three field goals last week, but special teams not their strength.
Yeah, for them, I think that's been clearly their Achilles heel all season long. Their special teams coverage has cost them a couple of football games, as well as their inability to really convert in field goals. And I think for Bethune-Cookman, they've had success running the football all night. Not sure how willing they are to come off of that game plan. And even with less than a minute to go in the half, we saw in the last play selection, they're still coming here to run the football tonight. They're not going to change just because there's 25 seconds left in the game.
programming reminder. Be sure to join us every Monday. It's the Palmer and Pollock Show on ESPNU at 1 and 9 Eastern. Jesse Palmer and David Pollock provide an interactive look at the past week's action and set the scene for the upcoming week's big games. Second and 10, 21 seconds to go in the half. Low snap again. Wilson flushed. Throws on the run and complete. It's Poole out of bounds on that near sideline. But they're now inside the 40, getting closer to field goal range.
You watch Poole, big physical body. Well, this is why you have to be so big. Look at that, grabbing and holding, tugging, go inside, then get back out. No, recognize my quarterback is scrambling to make the catch. That's why you like those big targets to throw through.
And that's 19 straight games with a catch. And a whistle. Looked like Poole got out of bounds. The clock should have stopped.
Yeah, that should have stopped there.
Timeout. Bethune Cookman. That's the third and final timeout of the half. It'll be a 30-second timeout.
Bethune Cookman instead uses its final timeout of the half. So 2 seconds left. They've got the ball at the 38-yard line. Let's go back to that last completion. No, that's the play that was whistled dead. Let's see if we can get that last completion. Looked like Poole was out of bounds, but he was ruled inbounds. Of course, the clock runs. And here's the play.
And we've got the clock right there next to you, so you see him get it. Pulled out of bounds. Should be 14-plus seconds left on that game clock. Bethune Cookman instead have to burn a timeout because they kept the game clock running.
Tough to see from that angle. Sideline a little cut off there, especially on the near side. But they'll attempt the long field goal. Sven Hurd, 55-yarder. Now Norfolk State wants to call a timeout. Hurd on the season, 5 of 8 on field goals. This is 13 yards longer than his longest made field goal. As long as just 42. And he's only attempted 3 field goals over 40 yards. He's not the long distance kicker like Everett Goldberg on the other sideline.
And he's going into the wind. So I think if you're Norfolk State right now, you've got to be thinking, just let him kick it, go at it, don't put an aggressive rush on him. And actually, if he can make it going in that direction of the stadium, so be it. You take your medicine, but don't allow them to try a fake or anything fancy. Try and score before the half.
Bethune Cookman, as a team, as a program, hasn't kicked a 50-yard field goal, hasn't made a 50-yard field goal since November of 2005. And they will not kick. They'll bring the offense back out on the field and try the old Hail Mary.
Another low snap.
Wilson flings it up there deep, and it is intercepted. Picked off to end the half. Ricardo Volson, the senior, comes down with it. And we go into halftime with the score 7-3. Really, defense conquered the first half for both teams.
Well, we'll see what the halftime adjustments are. We always say good coaches are measured by how their teams play in the second half. Pete Adrian has a lot of work to do for Norfolk State.
Norfolk State unbeaten in the MEAC, but down 4 going into the locker room. We now get it to the SportsCenter U studio. It's halftime, and here's Dari Noka.
Welcome to
the current BCS standings. And the band plays on.
The band is on the field!
Oh, but that's okay, because it's halftime. Bethune-Cookman 7, Norfolk State 3, second half. Coming up. Cap that.
This halftime right now.
You are watching ESPNU College Football Primetime presented by McDonald's. Your score at the half here in Norfolk. Bethune-Cookman 7, Norfolk State 3, with Jay Walker and Ace Schroff with you. Bethune-Cookman scored on its first drive, but since then their Speedway offense has been doing the speed limit. And meanwhile, for Norfolk State, they came in with Chris Wally, the MEAC's best quarterback, but Wally's world's been taken over, not by the Griswolds, but by that Bethune-Cookman front seven. Look at her Lexus playbook.
I mean, I think both teams came in there and played it pretty close to the best. Advantage Bethune-Cookman, if that's the case. They figured out a way to get to the best quarterback in the MEAC conference of Chris Wally, and he's just been flustered all day, never found a rhythm. A 71% passer has been extremely inaccurate thus far tonight. They've got to come out and just let it all go. Bethune-Cookman, keep that pressure on. Ryan Davis, Reggie Sandilan, they've been all over the field just harassing the Spartan offense. And not an easy day at the office tonight. 38 yards passing for a guy that averages over 234 yards per game passing. They've got to pick it up and let the ball fly.
The two things that we've seen here in the first half, we've seen Bethune-Cookman basically dare Norfolk State to throw the deep ball. And then we've seen Norfolk State basically dare Bethune-Cookman to just throw the ball, period.
And something's going to give. And typically you go in a conference or game, you've got your opponent there, you go with your tendencies. But once you realize it's not working in the first half, then the offensive coordinators are going to open up their playbook a little bit more and try and come out of their box. And I think the key for Norfolk State is they've got to figure out a way to get the ball to Boyce. I mean, they've got one of the best wide receivers in the conference. He's been kind of silenced by this Wildcat defense in the first half.
Bethune-Cookman to receive to start the second half. Courtney Keith from his 4-yard line. Across the 20. And Keith dives out of bounds at the 30-yard line. All right, let's see how both teams can get to a better state. Brought to you by State Farm.
Well, if you're Bethune-Cookman and you don't have that much faith in your quarterback, then keep running the football. They had success doing that, and they've got to keep the pressure on Chris Wally. Don't allow him to find his comfort zone. Norfolk State, conversely, they must protect Chris Wally. He's been rattled. He's been hit. And get away from the horizontal passing game. Go to the vertical passing game. Stretch the field. Test the Wildcats secondary.
Isidore Jackson in the backfield for Bethune-Cookman, 71 rush yards in the first half. And he gets the carry here on first down and gets to about the 34-yard line, a pickup of 4 yards on the play, second and six.
One of the things that Bethune-Cookman was able to do early was come out and establish control of the line of scrimmage. In the second half, you know Coach Brian Jenkins would love to show that type of dominance again in the trenches.
Jackson once more, and he gets across the 35 to the 38-yard line. A gain of three more. Corwin Hammond in on the stop.
Hammond's a guy that they try to funnel the runs towards. He's their inside linebacker, their run stuffer. They want Hammond to make the tackles. They just would prefer he make the tackles without giving up 4 yards a run.
Third straight run. Jackson's got a first down, and he gets across the 45-yard line. Nine more on the play.
You got that 3-4 look. Look at the left tackle. Watch the kickout block by Terrence Hackney. He seals the edge. Then they bring along Jonathan Moman from the fullback position, act as a lead blocker. That's stealing yards right there, Nish.
Fourth straight carry for Jackson out of halftime, and he's close to midfield. Hey, it's worked. Why not? He's close to 90 yards.
You've got to be thinking at some point Norfolk State's going to sell out, crowd the line of scrimmage, and bring an extra guy down.
And man limping on the field, that's big Josh Turner. And he seems to be okay. Making Michael Grant number 89. Grant, a sophomore out of Florida, and being helped off the field by the trainers. This is a Norfolk State defense. They're thin up front. They lost four defensive linemen before the season even started. Pete Adrian telling us their best D lineman, kid by the name of Tony Williams, told him he didn't want to play football anymore.
What do you do if you're a coach and that happens to you?
Jackson, nice spin move, still on
great
his
balance.
Feet. And he's finally brought down inside the 5-yard line. First and goal, Bethune-Cookman, a 49-yard gain, and Jackson over 100 yards on the evening.
Some people say that a running game is mental, and Bethune-Cookman wants it right now. Watch the balance. You see the big hole right there. Watch the explosion and the initial contact. great spin move, great balance by Jackson, switching the ball in his hands, getting every piece of yardage he can get, even at the end of the long carry.
This is Rodney Scott, and he gets to about the 2-yard line, second and goal. So we saw Bethune-Cookman on its opening drive of the game march down the field and score. Now their first drive of the second half trying to do the same.
And if running's mental, then what they're doing in the locker room is really coming out, paying off for them on the field. Great piece of running by Jackson, and the offensive line for Bethune-Cookman has played great football all evening.
Anthony Jordan in the game in the backfield for the Wildcats. Wilson rolls to his right. He'll try to run, and he'll be gobbled up. Back at the 6-yard line, a loss of 5 on the play. It'll bring up third down and goal. And now a bit of a decision for Brian Jenkins.
Yeah, that's what you can't do. You have the ball on the field where you can either run or throw. It's not there. You've got a guy in the back of the end zone. That's your go-to guy, Eddie Poole. Get the ball to him if you can. Throw the ball away, but don't get sacked or you're forcing it to be a passing situation.
You run or pass here.
You've got to pass the ball.
And Norfolk State calls a timeout here on third and goal. They haven't showed a lot of confidence in that passing game. Third and goal, Bethune-Cookman. We take a look at Saturday's college football menu. Jacksonville State takes on Kentucky. That's a noon Eastern start. Jacksonville State looking to knock off an SEC team for the second straight year. They beat Ole Miss in their season opener a year ago. Virginia home for North Carolina State. The Cavs coming off a big win against a Georgia Tech team that was undefeated at the time. Army and Vanderbilt, and then in the MEAC, it's FAMU against South Carolina State.
That game is very important as you take a look. Florida A&M has dropped 2 games in conference already.
Including one to Howard.
Including one to America's University, Howard University. All right. And then you got South Carolina State. They can't afford to lose another game. And something to be said, if you've got the postseason expanded from 16 teams to 20 teams in the playoffs, the MEAC was able to get 2 teams in the postseason last year. South Carolina State, they're in that trail position. If you want to win and make it to postseason play, you got to win out.
Big third and goal. Wilson throws, end zone, touchdown, Bethune-Cookman, K.J. Stroud.
Great coverage there. But the one thing that'll be good coverage is a better throw. The play action gets a nice throwing lane there. Stroud lays out for it. He made that catch with the defensive back, Matt Turner-Harris, draped all over him.
So the junior from Brooklyn, New York, giving Bethune-Cookman a 2-score lead.
The previous play is under review.
It looked close, and as the rules dictate, MEAC games that are televised, instant replay works like it would for an FBS game. They can review any play.
Yeah, will they have something conclusive to overturn it? And right there, it seems as if as soon as he caught that ball, he secured it and had it in his hand. The angle there.
Tough to tell from that angle.
Yeah, but he caught it pretty good.
Yeah, it looked
like he had it. He gripped it and tried to make clear that he had it. This is probably our best look.
Well, looks like his hands are underneath.
They're underneath, but I guess was there a little wiggle there? I mean, he did a really good job of holding on to that ball firmly.
It looked like he had control the entire time.
If you go along with the spirit of the law that says if you leave your feet, the process, you must catch the ball cleanly and have the ability to show it
which
to
he
the
did.
Official, which he had clearly.
You think of that call, the Bethune-Cookman-Hampton ending a few weeks ago. Play at the end, it looked like Bethune-Cookman had a touchdown. The receiver appeared to catch the ball. The play was reviewed. The call ended up being overturned because it was ruled he didn't really have control of the ball. And Rogers Redding, who's the head of NCAA officiating, we ran into him last week. And he basically told us the officials got that call in the Hampton Bethune-Cookman game right because, in essence, what the officials are told is after the player has the ball, even if he's in the end zone, he's got to come down and essentially show the ball to the officials. In that case, it looked like Stroud did that.
It looked like he did a good job of holding it and clinching it. Don't mention that Hampton game too close. You know, we're not too far away from Hampton.
Right.
That game is still lurking in the back of their minds. Let's hear what they say.
The ruling on the field is confirmed. Touchdown.
So the play stands. Touchdown, K.J. Stroud. And Bethune-Cookman can take an 11-point lead with the point after. Point after by Sven Hurd is good. Bethune-Cookman, they scored on their first drive of the game. They score on their first drive of the second half. A long run by Isidore Jackson. Set up a touchdown pass from Jackie Wilson to junior K.J. Stroud. Play, 70-yard drive capped by a K.J. Stroud touchdown has given Bethune-Cookman a 14-3 lead here in the third quarter. Let's now take a look at tonight's Bringing the Flavor, brought to you by McDonald's. Bethune-Cookman scoring on its first drive of the third quarter. And Jay, we talked about halftime adjustments, maybe Bethune-Cookman having to throw the ball more. Well, they didn't do that. They continued to run the ball, did it successfully. Even though the score came on a passing play, it was really the running game that got them into the red zone.
Yeah, they reemphasized run to where the bubble is. Try and knife that 3-4 defensive front. If you can hold the nose guard at bay and get up to the linebacker with the second levels, allow your athletic running backs to make plays.
So Norfolk State, undefeated in the MEAC, undefeated against FCS schools, down by 11 at home. Marcus Cooperwood feels it on a hop, gets across the 30. There's a flag down as he gets to the 40.
Turn. Illegal block in the back. Number 90. 10 yards from the spot of the foul. First down.
That's Chad Battles flagged on the play. And Chris Wally, Wally's World, they like to say around here. On the season, really good numbers. Well, tonight, completion percentage still more than serviceable, but only 38 passing yards in the first half.
Well, that's why you can't go for the statistics. 61% sounds like not bad, but 38 yards. What are you throwing for? You throw the football to move the ball down the field. They just have not done that tonight.
Come out in the Wildcat here on first down. Actually, that's the backup quarterback, Nico Flores. And a flag blows the play dead.
False start. Offense. Number 75. 5 yards. Still first down.
And that's one you can just blame. They're going to call it on Nico Washington, but you bring in your backup quarterback to run the Wildcat, you get used to certain voice fluctuations, and that's one where they just jumped off sides. Happens more often than you think when you bring in the backup quarterback.
And Chris Wally back in the game after the 5-yard penalty. Wally, quick throw. Reggie Garrett, he's across the 30, has some room. And he gets close to the 40-yard line and close to a first down, a gain of 15.
Yeah, just get rid of that ball as quickly as you can. And nice, accurate throw to hit Garrett in stride. And Garrett, good job of picking up yards after catch.
Man down on the field, and it's Gene Fanor, defensive back for Bethune-Cookman, and holding his helmet right now. Fanor, a fifth-year senior from Miami. Redshirted last year. He broke his foot last spring and then missed last season, recovering from the injury, and he's down on the field right now. Looking at the Sheridan poll, Alabama State right now, the number one team in black college football. 6-1. They're unbeaten in the SWAC. They got a big game coming up. Magic City Classic against Alabama A&M. And Norfolk State, they got a big game coming up a week from Saturday against North Carolina A&T. North Carolina A&T also unbeaten in the MEAC. And there's a thought that the winner of that game would be in the driver's seat to win the conference.
You've got some great matchups that are coming up. And I think, you know, the surprising story, obviously, seeing North Carolina A&T in the top 10, a team that won a game a season ago. And you take a look, they've still got some tough games ahead of them. The meat of their schedule, obviously, is coming up for A&T. They got to come to Norfolk State. They've got to go to Florida A&M. They've got to go to South Carolina State. Then when they play North Carolina Central in that Aggie Eagle Classic, that's always a toss-up game. You don't know what's going to happen. So give credit to Rod Broadway and A&T for getting out to the good start that they had to if they were talking about competing for the MEAC crown.
And on the flip side, Norfolk State's schedule, they got South Carolina State at home. They beat South Carolina State. They got Hampton at home, whom they beat. They get Bethune Cookman at home, who they're playing right now, and they're trailing. And they get North Carolina A&T at home. So they've gotten the tough teams in the MEAC all to come to Norfolk.
Yeah, and that helps. That helps. So, kids, they got to win them one game at a time. And right now, having home field advantage is not working out.
Wildcat again. This is Takeem Hedgman. And he's taking tacklers across the 40-yard line. He's got the first down.
That's one of the big changes in all of college football. No quarterbacks get under center. We haven't seen either team have a quarterback get under center. They bring in the little backup running back to run the Wildcat just to move forward.
And now Nico Flores in the game as the quarterback. And try the old jet sweep. Kelvin Lewis across midfield. Past the 45-yard line and a first down, 15 yards.
When you bring in Flores at the quarterback position, then you've got to protect the backside a little bit more compared to when Wally's in the game. And good job of running, getting to the outside there on the seal penetration. Look at the downfield blocking by Xavier Boyce. They're really putting tremendous pressure on the perimeter of the defense when they do that jet sweep.
Flores still in the game. This time he'll keep it himself right up the middle. Tackled by Jarkevis Fields, but he picks up five.
That's what you want right there. The team starts to focus on Nico Flores, the running quarterback, coming into the game, and he keeps it and picks up 5 yards.
Flores, a Central Florida transfer. They used him in the Wildcat a lot last year, and Chris Wally back in the game. Wally, quick screen. This is Hairston. And he fights his way down to the 35-yard line. Third down coming up.
And when the team starts throwing these wide receiver bubble screen, bubble screen, bubble screen, it kind of lulls the defense to sleep. Bethune Cookman has to be careful not to fall for the bubble screen and go. You know, fake the screen, double move, take off upfield.
Xavier Boyce has about a good 7-8 yards between him and the defender, bottom of your screen. Wally, here's Garrett. And again, there's that bubble screen, and Garrett takes it across the 30, 7 yards and a first down. Best looking drive of the game so far for Norfolk State.
And the key is the bubble screen. You have to have a rhythm. You almost want to rub between your offensive line and your wide receiver. Watch number 76. Go out there and seek somebody to hit. Use yourself as a screen to help free the wide receiver, Reggie Garrett, to pick up the first down.
Nico Flores back in the game at quarterback. We thought if anybody would switch out quarterbacks, it'd be Bethune Cookman, but it's been Pete Adrian in Norfolk State.
Now they've got to be careful because Flores can throw the football.
Flores this time will try to run it, and he's going to be stopped shy of the line of scrimmage by Ryan Davis. They called Davis's name a lot in the first quarter. Haven't called it as much since.
I think Norfolk State started to pay attention to him. They realized where he was on the field, shifted the line towards him, made it tough for him to get one-on-one opportunities.
Flores still in the game. You like this move by Pete Adrian, bringing in the backup quarterback?
I think so. I mean, if your starter's not working and you've got a package you can run with them, run that package.
Hedgman up the middle, has some room, and he gets inside the 25-yard line. Picked up 7 yards. DJ Howard on the stop, third down.
the more things you can force your defense to have to coordinate for and to watch, the more confusion you can cause. So they're looking for the quarterback to have the football. He hands it off to Hedgman that time, able to run the ball up the middle. And when Wally was there, they didn't have any success running the football. So I think it's a good move strategically to go with the rotating quarterbacks.
Five wide here on third and four. Wally back in the game at quarterback.
You got to like this. Everybody on Bethune-Cookman defense, you see him right now in your screen. That's how close they are to wide receivers. Daring you to throw the football, middle of the field's wide open.
Wally sacked for the fourth time. Ryan Davis. 2.5 sacks for Davis. And it's going to bring up fourth down.
And when you get that look, you know you've got to get rid of that ball a little bit quicker. 1,001, 1,002. It's got to be gone. He had nowhere to go with the football. And Wally just going down with not much of a fight there. Got to go somewhere with the football in that situation.
Everett Goldberg, who connected earlier from 50 yards on for a 47-yarder. Kick is up. And good. He's got a leg.
He's got a live leg, too. Hear that thud when it comes off his foot? Hits the sweet spot every time.
Norfolk State, it's rare in the FCS. They've got two scholarship kickers, two long field goals by Goldberg. The only scoring of the game for the Spartans. They're down 8.
For more than 30 years, the NCAA Division I Football Championship Subdivision has helped athletes achieve their dreams. The dream of playing football and hearing the home crowd cheer time after time. The dream of competing for a national championship. The dream of an excellent education. The dream of becoming a leader. And the dream of playing the right way with sportsmanship. NCAA Division I Football. It's not a dream. Come see for yourself.
For friends, for fun, for life. Forget the forecast, because the weather is seasonal. Life isn't. Introducing the all-new, all-affordable, all-season class leader, Extra 4X. Receive a $50 rebate at KumoTireUSA.com. Let's go.
ESPNU College Football Primetime is brought to you by Verizon 4G LTE, America's fastest, most reliable 4G network. That's the scene outside the Chrysler Museum of Art. 14-6, Bethune-Cookman leading Norfolk State. Chris Wally, Player of the Year candidate in the MEAC. He has been off his game. What has Bethune-Cookman done to frustrate him tonight?
Well, one, they've gotten up in the face of his wide receivers and challenged them with tough man-to-man coverage. And two, he doesn't know where the looks are coming from. So he thinks he's getting blitz, but they've been able to get to him with the four-man defensive rush. Sometimes they're doing zone blitz, never finding a rhythm. And his mental clock as a quarterback has been letting him down tonight. We saw in that last play there, they brought pressure up to the line of scrimmage. You got to know you got to get rid of that football. He didn't do it. So he's just, that lets me know that he's not seeing things well.
We heard all week about his quick release. He'd only been sacked 7 times coming into the evening. He's been sacked 4 times tonight.
And you got to give credit to Bethune-Cookman defense, but at the same time, some of those throws, get rid of the football. Sacks are never good. But when a quarterback doesn't necessarily know what he's looking at, they tend to hold on to the ball a split second longer, and that gives the defense an opportunity to react.
All that being said, it's still a one-possession game. Bethune-Cookman up by 8. A couple of long field goals, the only scoring of the game for Norfolk State. Bethune-Cookman scored on its first drive of the game and its first drive of the second half.
And if you're a body English guy, you don't like the body English right now you're getting from Chris Wall. He doesn't have that swagger that you want your quarterback to have when he's feeling confident.
Squib kick. It hits Jazz Moss. Nearly lost it. But he falls on it at the 19-yard line. Collective sigh of relief on the Bethune-Cookman sideline. Don't forget, Tuesday games coming up on Saturday. Got Jason Sehorn. Brad Edwards, our BCS analyst, will join us this week. Bob Davey. Joey Harrington.
It's a great show, but depends on who that host is sometimes.
Wow. This is Isidore Jackson. Tough yards for him, and he's got a first down.
And hard, good running is contagious. Jackson. When you've got running backs who are getting hit behind the line of scrimmage, they tend to start tiptoeing a little bit, but when they know the hole's going to be there, they run a little bit harder to the hole.
Jackson, 154 carries. That's a new career high. He set his career high last week when he had 150 against Fort Valley State. And they keep giving it to him. Jackson again.
Isidore Jackson again.
And he gets three, second down.
Good hard running, getting to the hole. And you can tell how he's got that body English. Hey, give me the ball again a little bit. Now you start to get the chess match. Norfolk State starts to substitute some bodies, go a little bit bigger at the outside linebacker position.
Norfolk State head coach Pete Adrian told us he'll rotate 18, 20 guys in on defense.
See, right now they're calling the check at the line of scrimmage. And the front they're getting right now, this means you go to some type of pass.
They'll run it. And Jackson's got a first down and more. Across midfield, nice stiff arm, and he's down inside the 45-yard line. A gain of 18 more.
See, schematically, they're telling you shouldn't be able to run the ball, but Bethune-Cookman's not buying it. They're saying you can try and force us to throw it. We're not going to. They've got the numbers in there. Good job of Jackson to just run it good and hard. And watch the Walter Payton tribute at the end of the run. You like that, the Walter Payton tribute, the stiff arm?
Stiff arm. Here's the Ole Miss transfer. Rodney Scott breaks the tackle in the backfield and plows forward close to the 35-yard line. He gets 8 yards, and it doesn't matter who's getting the ball. As long as Bethune-Cookman keeps it on the ground, they've had success.
Yeah, this is a great job by offensive coordinator Rob Spence for Bethune-Cookman. They like to run with misdirection. They want to try and throw the football, but the ability to make the adjustment, the running game is working. Keep running the football. Power football being put on display right now by the boys from Florida.
I don't think of power football when you think of spread offenses, but Bethune-Cookman, they use a fullback, technically not a spread, right?
Technically not a spread, but this is about as powerful a spread running game as we've seen this year. You know, you get the big bodies there, put some athletic backs there in the backfield.
Loss on the play.
They've been able to have their way. Doesn't hurt that they're going against a 3-4 defense. You should be able to run the ball against his three down linemen versus the conventional four defensive linemen right on the line of scrimmage.
And lost a yard on that last play. They'll go four wide on third down. And a timeout. Play clock was running down.
Timeout. Bethune-Cookman. It's a second charge timeout. Maybe a 30-second.
One timeout left in the half for Bethune-Cookman, but they've got the lead.
Hey.
You're watching ESPNU College Football Primetime presented by McDonald's. Before we went to break, you heard the head referee Donnell Leathers say that Bethune-Cookman had used its second timeout. It was actually their first timeout. It'll be third down Wildcats. They've done it on the ground so far, more than 200 yards rushing.
Running back by committee. This is Jonathan Moment, the fullback that ran the ball in the end zone. Isidore Jackson's been fantastic. Good heart, aggressive running all night long, taking it to the defenders, and then they brought in Rodney Scott. Give him a little change of pace. He's also doing a good job running the football. Bethune-Cookman showing how to get it done on the ground using the spread offense.
They're already past their average for rushing yards per game, averaging almost 216 at 218 with a whole quarter to play and about 5 minutes to play here in the third quarter. And it's not one guy. I mean, Isidore's had a terrific game, but normally they rely on four or five guys in that running game. They've got a stable.
Running back by committee is how they make their living. And Norfolk State refuses to go away from the three-man line.
Wilson throwing long, and it's picked off. Devontae Reynolds.
Devontae
Second interception thrown by Wilson this evening.
Watch Devontae Reynolds. He's playing safety, coming over there. He's just roaming, looking at the eyes, and once he sees the ball's in the air, he beats the intended receiver, Mark Francois, to the point of where the ball's coming down. And Wilson's going to let this ball go early. Throws it before the wide receiver's out of his break. Reynolds has a beat on it before Francois can see it. Nice interception by Reynolds.
We saw a lot of Nico Flores at quarterback on the last drive for Norfolk State, but it's Chris Wally taking the snaps once again. Here's Hedgman. And he got maybe a yard, second down and nine, tackled by Ryan Davis.
When your defense makes that turnover for you, most offenses like to get that quick strike, try and get some momentum and change the momentum of the game. With the pass, they come out trying to run the football. Just shows you how frustrated they are offensively tonight.
In the Wildcat now. Here's Hedgman. Up the middle, and there did not look to be much room there, and no surprise, Hedgman didn't get much.
Now, we've never seen Bethune-Cookman get pushed around the football field. It doesn't look as if Norfolk State's going to be able to push them around as well. We come out in the obvious Wildcat run formation, they rise to the occasion.
And almost every time they've run the Wildcat, it's been right up the middle.
Right up the middle, 1 or 2 yards, not fooling anybody.
Big third down for Norfolk State. Wally. Under pressure, off his back foot, incomplete. He wanted Hairston, but not even close. Fourth down.
As a quarterback, have you ever heard the term happy feet? This is when you've got happy feet. He's looking at the rush. Going there, you see something. He's not stepping up.
Who's
open, looking
though?
At the rush. Yeah, so what you do is you don't start running sideways. You step up in the pocket to buy that extra second. Maybe you pull a linebacker that focuses on you and you free somebody. But right now it seems as if Wally doesn't know where the rush is coming from, and he's just trying to make sure he doesn't get hit.
Low snap. Menzer gets it off. Takes a bounce of the 45. And it's down to the 44-yard line. A 34-yard punt, no return. Saturday morning, ESPNU previews a full day of college football at 9 a.m. Eastern. Join it. Bethune-Cookman ball from the 44-yard line. Isidore Jackson on first down, and he gets to the 45, a gain of a yard.
Now you've got to start to worry about the wear and tear on your defense if you're Norfolk State. Last drive, Bethune moved the ball down the field, had the turnover. Offense didn't capitalize, three plays in punt. Now you're right back on the field again.
Clock running down. Bethune-Cookman uses its second timeout. Looking at Jackie Wilson, their quarterback there. Going into the game, Jay, one of the storylines we talked about was who's going to play quarterback. Brian Jenkins waited right up until game time, literally a game time decision, to name his quarterback. He had three guys to choose from. David Blackwell started last week. Jackie Wilson had started the games before that against Miami and North Carolina A&T. Jamar Robinson was the guy who started the season, and Brian Jenkins had all three were in play, but really doesn't matter who he chose because the quarterback for the most part has been a non-factor in Bethune-Cookman's attack.
And for them, when you talk to opposing coaches, they all play alike. When you talk about Robinson, Blackwell, and Wilson, it's not as if one of them's a runner, the other one's a thrower. It's not as if one is 6'5 and the other is 5'11. They're all right around 6 feet tall. They all weigh around 200 pounds, and they do the same type of thing. But my comfort level as a quarterback, I feel uncomfortable. You put a lot of stress on a quarterback when you're wondering what's going on the sideline if you play bad.
Wilson gets back to the line of scrimmage. It'll bring up third down.
And let's say this. Let's give Coach Jenkins his credit. I guess he knew something we didn't know, that going into this game, the quarterback wasn't going to be a factor. The game was going to be either won or lost with his offensive line, his running backs, and thus far it seems to be working with the 14-6 lead.
They haven't had to play from behind. That helps.
And that would have been the interesting part. Had Norfolk State been able to do like they normally do, which is get the lead early and hold on to it.
Movement up front, and Bethune-Cookman jumped.
And right now we're going to see how much confidence.
Four star on the offense. Number 79, 5-yard penalty, still third down.
Got the penalty there on Marquel Rozier, but right now we're going to see how much confidence Coach Jenkins has in the quarterback position. Quarterback just threw an interception on the last possession. Now you've got third, it was third and 10, now third and 15. Obvious passing situation. I look for him to run the football.
And they do. It's Jackson. Breaks one tackle and tripped up at the 43-yard line. So fourth down coming up. Was the strategy here to win the field position game, given how well Bethune-Cookman's defense is playing?
Yeah, he's going to allow the defense to do it. And he's not going to trust the quarterbacks anymore. There won't be any passing situations unless it's a very easy read. And you've got a running back that's getting it done like this tonight. 181 yards rushing on the ground. Great offensive line play.
Two terrific games in a row for Jackson at 150 last week. That was a career high. Kowalski gets this kick off. Not a good punt. And it's going to go out of bounds at the 37-yard line. Only a 20-yard punt. So when Brian Jenkins called that run play on third down, that's not what he had in mind with the special teams performance.
And that's been one of the things that have troubled the Wildcats. Their special team play at times has been spotty. And this type of contest, you're playing a good team, you give them this type of field position, they'll normally make you pay for it.
Nico Flores back in at quarterback for Norfolk State. The Central Florida transfer, Chris Wally, watches on the sidelines. They fake the jet sweep. Flores up the middle, trying to spin to the 40, but tackled shy of the 40. Does pick up three on the play.
We know that Flores has great running ability, but when you're going against an aggressive defense like this, you got to protect that football. He runs a little bit high in the hole.
Now, when he's been in the game, they haven't called a pass play. So if you're Bethune-Cookman, do you even play the pass here? You know what I mean?
You've got to be safe because he's 4 of 6 throwing the ball on the year, and he is the backup quarterback. He can throw, and he goes downfield when he does.
He'll run again here. Flores took a tackler with him, and he gets 2 yards. Who else? Ryan Davis brings him down.
That's that engine you have to have when you're going to play defensive end.
As Chris Wally comes back in the game on a passing down here on third. Let's see if Norfolk State elects to call a play as there's only 10 seconds left in the third quarter.
Giving Wally that pressure look like they're bringing everybody. Everybody's close on the line of scrimmage right now.
They get the play off. Wally under pressure, chased by Davis. Throws on the run, throws long, and Victor Hairston can't haul it in. That's the first time they've gone vertical all game. And that takes us to the end of the third quarter. Chris Wally, hands on his hips. It's been that kind of evening for Norfolk State. Undefeated in the MEAC. Could that end tonight? Isidore Jackson, a career high 181 yards for Bethune-Cookman. Ryan Davis has been all over the Norfolk State offense, and Chris Wally. And Wally, who came into this game as a candidate for MEAC Player of the Year, 11 for 18, only 62 yards, and he's been sacked 4 times. In Norfolk State, they've got a big game looming in their next contest against North Carolina A&T. They would like a 0 in the loss column going into that game. And for Bethune-Cookman, obviously, a win here puts them back in the picture in terms of maybe competing for a MEAC championship, but also would give them a chance to maybe get a bid to the postseason, even if they don't win the conference.
And they've got some good games ahead of them, so they can also knock off some folks, but it all starts with knocking off the team right now that's in first place in conference.
Preston Cleckley lets this one bounce, and it's down inside the 5-yard line. So a big special teams play. Nice punt by Troy Menzer. It went 52 yards. And Bethune Cookman will start inside its 5-yard line. Isidore Jackson has moved the chains offensively for the Wildcats.
Yeah, good hard running. And you see the push downfield by the offensive line. They've really done a good job of having wide open holes for Jackson to take advantage of. And I like the fighting Jackson at the end of all these runs, never going down without a fight, showing great balance, great strength, and really trying to take it to the opposing defense.
Talking to Brian Jenkins earlier this week, he said Jackson this season at times was hesitant, really broke out last game, and he wants to see more of that from his young running back. Rodney Scott gets the call on first down. He gets it across the 5-yard line. And now Bethune Cookman motioning to its sideline. It appears there's a man down. And one of the linemen down on the field, it's the right tackle, Alex Monroe.
With the success they've had running the football tonight and the way that offensive line has played spectacularly, you would hate to see them go down a man because of injury.
Bethune-Cookman, they lost the MEAC Offensive Player of the Year, Matt Johnson, who was so vital to their success last year. But the one strength for this team has been the offensive line. It's one of the reasons Jackson's been able to run for 181 yards.
Yeah, they really rose to the challenge. You can tell the mental mindset of these young men tonight. We got to come out, establish control of the line of scrimmage, and they did that from their very opening possession. Rammed the ball down the field on the Spartans, and they continued to do it all night long.
Jackson, 181 yards, the all-time single-game rushing record. You might be able to guess this. It's not a running back, it's a quarterback.
Alan Suber,
who's the wide receivers coach for the Wildcats.
Suberman was something special. He's one of those MEAC legends in terms of football, one of the guys that really brought the resurgence back in this Bethune-Cookman program.
Ran the Wyatt bone for all those years under Alvin Wyatt, and he's now on Brian Jenkins' staff as the wide receivers coach. And you know who else is on the staff of Brian Jenkins? Their running backs coach is Autry Denson, Notre Dame's all-time leading rusher, who's coaching high school football in Florida, and Brian Jenkins brought him over to his staff. So Isidore Jackson with 181 yards, Autry Denson up in the booth, smiling at that performance, no doubt.
Got to be proud. Denson's a first-year coach there, Bethune-Cookman, so now maybe they're starting to take the coach, and they can learn a little something from these moves right here.
Look at that, Notre Dame MVP, played there 4 seasons, and the school's all-time leading rusher. When you're the school's all-time leading rusher, and the school is Notre Dame, that says something. They've had a few good players throughout the years.
One or two.
Wilson throws on first down, and it's complete, far sideline. Gain of 7 yards, Eddie Poole with the catch.
With them having to make a change in the offensive line, they decided to not run the football for one of the few times I thought they obviously would run the ball. Now setting up a third and manageable 2 yards. Norfolk State's bringing pressure, trying to do a run blitz.
And Rodney Scott tackled by Terrence Pugh, and he is going to be short of the first down. There is a flag on the play.
There's Alan Suber right there.
Dead ball. Personal foul. Offense. Number 22. At the distance. Fourth down.
So they decided to bring a run blitz right there. You see the safety. That's Reynolds, number 30, Devontae Reynolds. He's the free safety. You see free safeties that close to the line of scrimmage. They brought up the secondary in order to stop the running game. That's been the only way they've been able to do it tonight.
So we talked about field position not long ago when Bethune-Cookman was punting from its own 40, but Norfolk State's last punt has Bethune pinned deep. They've got a punt now from their own end zone. Game could turn here. Kowalski with a short kick, fielded by Cooper Wood at the 45, goes backwards, and now gets across the 40-yard line. So terrific starting field position for the Spartans as they try to claw back down eight. It's the fourth quarter. Will Wally's World finally open for business? Stay tuned.
Team is not something you do alone. Team is plural. Team is arms, legs, blood, sweat.
ESPNU College Football Primetime is presented by McDonald's. I'm loving it. Alongside former Howard quarterback Jay Walker and East Shroff, we're in Norfolk, Virginia. Bethune-Cookman scored on its first drive of the game and its first drive of the second half. Norfolk State, two long field goals by Everett Goldberg, accounting for their scoring. They have the ball, though, at the Bethune-Cookman 38-yard line after a short punt by the Wildcats. The best starting field position for either team. The Spartans, they've been frustrated by this Wildcat defense. How do they need to attack Bethune-Cookman?
They've got to go with the vertical passing game, and I think we saw it in the last incomplete pass from Chris Wallet. Although it was an incompletion, he did at least threaten the defense with the deep ball. Ball just went off the fingertips of the intended target. If you get that look again, take the same shot, stand a little bit firm in the pocket, maybe make a better throw. You can hit a blitzing defense with big plays. You're just not going to nickel and dime them all the way down the field. So this is a look. They're challenging him again right now. They're saying throw the football.
This is Wally. And he runs it forward for about 3-4 yards. It'll bring up second down.
And that's that look. I mean, it's tough to run against a seven-man defensive front, but when they bring eight people in the box and they're playing man-to-man coverage, those running lanes are going to be very, very tight.
Nico Flores now in the game at quarterback. And Bethune crowding that box, daring him to run.
I mean, you've got your go-to
daring
guy.
Daring to throw, I should say.
Boyce right here on the bottom of the screen, one-on-one coverage. Give him a shot.
He took a screen pass 49 yards for a touchdown last week. Flores, right up the middle, looked like he ran into his own man. Third down coming up.
Well, they're just trying to knife the defense. He goes there, and a good job of reaction by Jamil. Sorry, that's Tevin Toney from that defensive line position.
Wally back in the game. Third down and seven. Empty backfield. I've got two tight ends and presumably to block.
Well, now they've got Boyce in the slot trying to make him the most dangerous man on the field. But the problem is Bethune has reacted. They've got three defensive backs on that side.
Wally hit as he throws. Ryan Davis knocked the ball out and Tevin Toney fell on it. It is a fumble and Bethune-Cookman has the football. Wally had Reggie Garrett wide open for a screen if he wanted it. And I think he was targeting Boyce.
Yes, he tried to lock in on him. And they made the adjustment as well. And you're going to see Ryan Davis come from around the end and make that strip right there. Good job. And keep the quarterback away from the ball. It's on the turf. And Tevin Toney's there. You see him right there. Good speed move around the edge. He should not be able to do there. When you've got your fullback in the game to help block on that side, Ryan Davis should not be able to get to your quarterback that quickly.
So a turnover for Norfolk State as they forfeit what was their best starting field position of the game, the best starting field position for either team. Jackson on first down. And he gets to the 36 and pick up the yard. How about the game Ryan Davis is at? We highlighted him at the top of the broadcast.
Very active, and you can see why he's an all-conference performer. And seems like his senior season, he's going to be an All-American performer from that defensive end position. He's got that type of motor that you want to have in great size. 6'4", 240-plus pounds. He showed off all of his moves, the speed rush, the bull rush, the spin moves. He's a complete package.
We asked Brian Jenkins if he can play on Sundays, and he didn't hesitate. He said, without question.
No question.
Wilson has time. He's going to go deep. He wants Stroud. And Stroud can't haul it in.
Now that was a pass. That's one where if you're Keith Stroud, you've got to come down with this football. Quarterback stands strong in the pocket. Plenty of air on this ball so you can readjust. Look at this, thrown in good rhythm, good timing, outside shoulder. Going to hit him right in that glove. You've got to come down with that football there. I'm with you, quarterback. You can't throw it any better than that.
Bethune-Cookman, 5 of 11 on third down.
They've got that same look. If they want to go back to it, man-to-man coverage at the bottom of your screen.
Here's the pressure. Wilson throws deep for Poole and just a little out of his reach. Fourth down.
Now that's one that Wilson wished he could have back. The first throw was perfect. That one there, Poole got a great release. Look at this. You're going to see it right here in the bottom of your screen. Look at that release. I mean, he's beating him by 3 yards. You got to stick that on him. And, oh, just threw it a little bit too far down the field.
So how about Brian Jenkins and Bethune-Cookman trying to open it up a little bit, unsuccessful, but had a couple chances there.
Yeah, when the team starts making adjustments, you go attack vertically. How about Norfolk State? I mean, they haven't moved the ball all night, but they're still just down by one score in a two-point conversion.
Ball takes a Bethune-Cookman bounce. It'll roll inside the 10, and it's going to be down at the 5-yard line, a 58-yard punt by Corey Kowalski. Norfolk State has 95 yards to go when we return. Norfolk State down 8 with 11:05 to play in the fourth quarter. Saturday night, we get to see a couple of Heisman hopefuls. Two guys that Jay really likes, Trent Richardson in Alabama, home for Tennessee. That's 7:15 on ESPN2. And then Russell Wilson, sixth-ranked Wisconsin Badgers. Big road test for them. They go to East Lansing. That's the ESPN Saturday night game. Comes your way at 8 p.m. And Jay, Russell and Trent, are these your top choices for the Heisman right now?
I think so. I think if you call it a two-man race, these would be the two front runners. I mean, Russell Wilson's been phenomenal. Great touchdown interception rating. Undefeated, what you want. Trent Richardson, I mean, you know, I know it was against Ole Miss, but that run that he made, that was one of the best dead legs you'll find in any level of football, college, professional, high school. He made that guy look like he was playing Pop Warner.
Their own 5-yard line, Nico Flores to throw for the first time. He's got a man wide open. It's Hairston who hauls it in at the 19-yard line. It's good for 14 and a first down.
And I like the way he composed himself in the pocket. After you fake the jet sweep, watch him just buy a little time, find the lane, settle in the pocket, and deliver a strike to Victor Harrison, who they like to use in that slot position to really get him in one-on-one matchups versus linebackers.
He's a converted running back and a lot of speed. There's the jet sweep, Kelvin Lewis. And he's tripped out of bounds as he crosses the 25-yard line. Picked up 7.
Kelvin Lewis. You know, if they can start gaining yards running that jet sweep, and then you've got Flores that can give you that threat of running, and he threw the ball pretty well. Well enough, I thought, to keep going to him, but got to go with the guy that got you here. While he's your guy, you got to keep going with him and hope. It's like playing basketball. What do you want, Michael Jordan, to keep shooting, or you want to start passing?
Right. Wally back in. And a flag.
False start on the offense. Number 77, 5 yards, still second down.
We mentioned it earlier in the game. When you've got quarterback voices that have different fluctuations, the one area where you really affect yourself is your offensive line. They get used to hearing a certain rhythm, and then you can bring in another person with a certain rhythm, and they tend to jump off sides.
Wally, quick release. Here's Garrett. He has some room, and Garrett has got a first down as he gets across the 30-yard line. But Bethune-Cookman saying the ball came loose, and they've got it, waiting for an official signal. Officials talking it over. Bethune-Cookman's saying, we got it.
They've got to call it one way or the other. Then you know whoever it is going to end up challenging this, I'm sure. But you got to get the official's call.
Well, they can review the play, too.
The ruling on the field is under review. The previous play is under review.
So now they're going to see if Garrett did indeed fumble the football, or if he was down. Now, was he down before that ball came out? So the ground can't cause a fumble.
It seemed like he was on somebody's back. See, he's got the ball in one hand. He's on somebody's back. Oh, it comes out before he touches the ground.
The ruling on the field was that Garrett was down. Bethune-Cookman, they saw the ball come out. They pounced on it. And you saw their defense signaling that they had possession.
He's going to lose that. Yeah. That's a fumble. That's a fumble there. He's going down clearly. But that ball's coming out before I see anything touch. Now, was that back knee down? And guess who recovered the fumble?
Number 49, Ryan Davis.
Ryan Davis, he's got that motor, that engine. Let's see the leg. The leg.
I don't think there's any part of him that's down.
No. He was going horizontal.
He's on a player.
Because you got to tell yourself at the same time, had he kept his balance, how often have we seen a running back spin around and get up and keep running?
And he was trying to stretch for some extra yardage, but the ground didn't cause that fumble. If the ground causes the fumble, they'd retain possession. The ground didn't cause that fumble. That was coming out before the ball even got close to the ground.
And this is very crucial in this football game right now, because if Bethune is able to come away with the football right now and kick one more field goal,
it's a two-possession game.
And the way Norfolk State has not been able to move the football, you could almost say it would be a wrap.
Officials reviewing the play. If you're just joining us, before you couldn't review plays in the FCS until you got to the postseason, but the rule this year in the MEAC, televised MEAC games, instant replay is in effect like it would be for the FBS, where they could review any play.
And hats off to Commissioner Dennis Thomas, who's here in attendance tonight at this game, for realizing if we're going to have a game on television and the technology is available to us, then we should use it. And I think he really deserves credit for that. And some people may not like it, because if you're on the wrong decision for one of these overturned calls, but the former player in me says, get it right. Get it right on the field, and let's allow the game to be called the right way.
Again, the call on the field was that the player was down. Replay showed he fumbled.
I believe he fumbled as well.
The call on the field is reversed. It is a fumble. The ball be placed on the 31. Please reset the game clock to 10:22. First down.
Doesn't it look like that screen could be called the thrill of victory and the agony of defeat? Jenkins was celebrating. Adrian was realizing that, wow, he's really put his team in another bind with that fumble.
Second turnover for Norfolk State. That's part of what made Bethune-Cookman so good last year, turnover margin, or even in this game, but they were so good at forcing other teams to make mistakes and capitalizing on them. That's why they were 10-2 a year ago.
They led the nation in turnover margin a season ago. Haven't been that effective this year because they've been turning the football over, but this is still a very opportunistic defense.
Isidore Jackson tackled after no gain, second down.
And I like the defensive play selection here by Pete Adrian, the defensive coordinator, Mark Bassiani. Right now, you want to try and crowd that line of scrimmage. If they beat you with a deep throw, okay. But if you can get a couple tackles for losses to make this a very long field goal attempt if they have to settle for it. So right now, they're doing all or nothing, crowding the line of scrimmage.
That's 3-1. 45 rushes, 15 pass attempts. I was not a math major. Did that off the top of my head. Jackson. Again to the run, and Jackson able to break tackles initially, getting to that second level, and he got 6 yards out of what seemed like was going to be a two-yard game.
Yeah, great effort. That's been the story of Jackson all night long. But at the end of the run, finishing off the runs, not giving up, keeping his legs going, trying to deliver a blow. Second effort, picked up extra yardage on that play.
He's 10 yards away from 200 rushing yards on the evening. Wilson rolls to his left. He wanted Francois to the backfield, but good defense there by Norfolk State. Terrence Pugh able to get in the way of that pass, and it's fourth down.
Yeah, they're bringing man-to-man coverage, bringing the blitz in. See there, good job by Pugh of recognizing that Francois, the slot receiver, gotten behind him.
Now, there's a big difference between the two teams. Norfolk State, if they were in Bethune-Cookman's shoes right here, would kick a field goal, and you'd feel confident. This is a 40-yard attempt for Bethune-Cookman and Sven Hurd, by no means a gimme. And that's not close.
You called it, Nish. You called it, but that's the difference between the two teams. One team, it's almost like a chip shot for a team struggling. Spotty special team, it's tough.
Brian Jenkins knows his team missed an opportunity to cash in on a turnover. Pete Adrian's Spartans still have some life. And there's plenty of time left. Back in Norfolk, you're looking at the USS Wisconsin. Norfolk State trailing Bethune-Cookman 14-6, less than 9 minutes to play in regulation. With Jay Walker and Ishraf, we were on the USS Enterprise earlier this morning. Brian Jenkins is trying to get out of town with a victory.
By land, by sea, by boat, however he can do it. Give credit to this Bethune-Cookman defense and offensive line. The defense for Bethune-Cookman has been superb, limiting Norfolk State to only 6 points thus far, but 8 minutes to go. Can they hold on? Seems to be the question of the night.
Wally slings it out to Hairston, and that was nearly intercepted. Oh, Bethune-Cookman read that. Reggie Sandilands playing the passing lane.
When you've got a linebacker that the coaches say he'll be a coach one day, you know, he's that type of assassin. He's got a high football IQ. He's going to be in the right place to make a play. Have we seen Chris Wally step up and make one solid throw all night? I mean, you normally...
Surprising.
I mean, we haven't seen him step up, make one quality good throw where you're like, ooh, wee, that's a quarterback. Just lets me know how confusing they are to him.
And that's why Nico Flores is in the game. This is Kelvin Lewis on a jet sweep, and Lewis turns on the Jets to get to the 30-yard line. That play's worked a few times for Norfolk State.
Yeah, they've done that time and time again, and surprised that they've had success. I saw some film of them do it against West Virginia. Also saw them do it versus Howard University. That's one of their features. You know, we're talking about Chris Wiley feeling comfortable in the pocket. You know, he's there just kind of a little jittery, not smooth. That's not a throw you feel that confidently throwing.
On a lot of plays, Jay, it seems like he's had time.
He has, but, you know, because they got to him early, and then he's confused whether or not they're blitzing him or not, he just doesn't feel comfortable in that pocket.
And now he burns a timeout. Second charge timeout for Norfolk State. With 8:25 to go, we remind you this Saturday, full menu of college football on ESPNU. Can Jacksonville State do it again? They were an FCS team a year ago. They beat Ole Miss, trying to beat an SEC school for the second straight year. They get Kentucky in Lexington, Virginia off that big win against Georgia Tech, home for NC State. Vandy and a fired up James Franklin, home for Army, and FAMU goes to Orangeburg to take on South Carolina State. And here is that Jacksonville State Ole Miss game from a year ago. Jacksonville State trailed 31-10 at halftime, but they outscored Ole Miss 21-3 in the fourth quarter to force overtime. Kevin Cooper holding a 30-yard touchdown pass in double overtime, and then this two-point conversion. Hey, why not? Go for the win. They went for two in double overtime. They pulled off the stunner, 49-48. Right now, Jacksonville State eighth in the FCS. Norfolk State 25th in the coaches' poll. And we'll say this, Norfolk State and Bethune Cookman both had a big FBS opponent on their schedule this year. Norfolk State led West Virginia at the half. That's their only loss of the season. They were blown out in the second half. And Bethune-Cookman hung with Miami for three quarters.
I mean, they've got some talent to play. It's just they don't have the depth to compete, play and play again.
On third down, Wally throws, and it's broken up. He wanted Xavier Boyce. Fourth down.
You know, this is a timer route. Let's see, if you're going to throw that out route, it's got to be one, two, three, let it go. That extra step cost him, allows the defensive back to come around and break. I mean, that's QB 101. Those out routes to the sideline, those are timing routes. You've got to get in rhythm, let it go, throw it to a spot, not to a target.
Boyce, the Virginia Tech transfer, left school after he was accused of child endangerment, was indicted. His high school coach is the quarterback's coach at Norfolk State. As Bethune-Cookman falls on that at the 33-yard line. And it was Boyce's high school coach who vouched for him, told Pete Adrian to take a chance on him, and Boyce ended up here in Norfolk.
That's what you're going to need a coach stand up for. But take a look at this FCS top 10 poll there. You know, Georgia Southern's really getting it done running the football. Northern and Appalachian State. Some people feel that the Southern Conference is playing the best football in the whole country right now in terms of FCS football. And that's why, isn't it so exciting? They got playoffs to determine who really does have the best team in niche.
Oh, is the CAA once again the best conference?
Excuse me? And when you get conference play, you got different conferences. Obviously, you know, the CAA conference gets 5 to 6 teams in every year. But the Ohio Valley, that's the OVC, that's where Jacksonville State is.
Well, the MEAC got 2 last year, which was a big deal. That hadn't happened since 1999. Question is, can they get 2 this year?
Will be tough, and I think the reason South Carolina State was able to get in, they had 2 losses on their record. And you're talking about a program that over a 2-year stretch went 18-4, never got to play in postseason, so they kind of owed it to the Bulldogs last year.
Flag on the play.
False start on the offense. Number 79, 5-yard penalty, still second down.
What's hurt the MEAC in the past is this is a conference. They've had some good teams, but they haven't won a playoff game since 1999, more than a decade.
Yeah, and that happens. You know, and you've got to think, when you only get one team in there and seeding some of it, I think the Hampton squad had enough star power to win a game. They actually got to host 2 football games in the postseason, but they didn't walk away with the victory. That really does become detrimental to your conference. You're exactly right.
Jackson still running strong, and he gets across the 35-yard line. Jamal Giddens brought him down after a 4-yard gain.
You know, you talk about postseason play. If Norfolk State loses this game tonight, then you really lit a fire in a bunch of teams in the MEAC conference that thought they might have been out of it had Norfolk State won this game tonight. South Carolina State's going to pick it up. Florida A&M's going to pick it up. Bethune-Cookman is going to pick it up.
That last run got Jackson to 200 yards on the night, a new career high. And this is Jackson again, fighting for yards on third down.
What effort.
And he's going to be close to a first down. Appears to be short, but it'll be close.
I mean, what an effort. I mean, from the time he got hit, it looks like he's stoned. Right there, he's stoned. They've got him. Now watch the effort that he does in order to keep going, keep bouncing. Look at the left leg, bring the right leg. He almost got that first down. This is just hard-nosed running. Securing the football, looking, pulling, dragging, twisting. Ah, that's how you run the rock.
They're going to measure. And he did. No. Oh, that much.
Heart and determination. I mean, it was all in that effort. He could have gone down and come up 1 or 2 yards short, but he willed himself beyond the first down marker.
What did Al Pacino say? That inch, that's what he got the first down by, that inch. Fight for that inch. Any given Sunday. Thursday night here in Norfolk. Jackson once again, that time wrapped up in the backfield by Terrence Pugh.
When you realize you can't bring them down if you've got the right scheme in place, what do? You crowd the box. You bring an extra defender in to make the tackle for loss. And they've done this time and time again. They've gone to the run blitz, but the moment they come off of that aggressive run defense, Bethune-Cookman makes them pay.
And some of Norfolk State's better defensive players come in on passing downs. You saw number 90 check into the game, Chad Battles. They haven't been able to use them much because Bethune-Cookman hasn't thrown the ball much. They don't throw it here. It's Jackson once again. And he's tackled by Amici Anyago after a gain of three.
And you talk about Chad Battles coming in the game because they've made the adjustment. They're going with four defensive linemen for the first time in the game. You see Battles there, 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 there. They're known for that 3-4 defense, but when it's not working, bring in some more beef in order to slow down the run. Out of character for the Spartans. They're going with it again. Another four down defensive lineman.
So Bethune-Cookman getting a different look. Wilson, he'll step up, and he goes down. Got two on the play, but it's going to bring up fourth down.
But not only did they go with four defensive linemen, but they also decide to get their run-stopping linebacker, Corwin Hammond, up the middle on a linebacker blitz. He didn't get there, but he was able to flush Wilson out of the pocket.
Hammond leads the team in tackles. One of the glue guys on that linebacking unit. Good kick by Kowalski. Cooperwood back at his own 10-yard line. Slips one defender. A lot of dancing, and he gets to about the 18-yard line, and that's where Norfolk State will take over. 46-yard punt, 9-yard return. We're still waiting for Wally's World to be open for business. Ryan Davis, though, has kept the chains on the park.
Mid-Eastern.
With Jay Walker, I'm in a Shroff. The visiting band has a lot to be joyous about. Bethune-Cookman leading 14-6. The Wildcats scoring on their first drive of the game and their first drive of the second half. Norfolk State held the two long field goals. And really, Jay, the story of this game has been Isidore Jackson running the football for the Wildcats offensively, and then the defense has kept the Spartans in check the entire game.
They've done a fantastic job, and Norfolk State still has not figured out what Bethune-Cookman has done to them defensively. When your quarterback's struggling, go to your running game. And Bethune-Cookman followed that recipe to a T, with Isidore Jackson leading the way, over 200 yards rushing in this contest. Great gutsy effort.
Chris Wally, Norfolk State's quarterback, came into this game as maybe the front runner for MEAC Player of the Year, but he has struggled in this contest. Completion percentage is okay, not a lot of yards. He's been under pressure all game. And it's not Wally, but Nico Flores who comes out to start this drive at quarterback for the Spartans.
Whoever the quarterback may be, they need to start going to the vertical passing game.
Flores has time, and there's a vertical pass. He wants Boyce. And Boyce comes down with it, the Virginia Tech transfer, and Norfolk State breathes some much-needed life into its offense.
If you've got an offensive weapon like Xavier Boyce, give him a chance to make a play. Throw it up, make sure the free safety can't intercept. Double post pattern call, great readjustment by Boyce to come down with the football.
46 yards for the former Hokie. And now Flores will keep it himself, and he gets to about the 35, tackled by Sandilands.
Now don't stop. Don't stop right now. You saw what Boyce can do. Now this is when you want to get him schematically and what type of formation where you can assure him a one-on-one matchup and give him two shots at the end zone. Everything else you've tried thus far tonight has not worked. I think you've got to find a way to give your playmaker another chance to make a play.
Boyce lined up at the top of your screen. Flores looks his way. Here's Boyce. And he gets to the 30-yard line. Gain of 5 yards. It'll bring up third down and short.
But that's what you want to do. Get him the ball. You can tell when he catches the ball, he knows what to do with it. Got you on the edge of your seat, makes the first guy miss, picks up a couple extra yards. At 6 feet, 4 inches, 220 pounds, he's an explosive playmaker.
Top receiver in the MEAC, 20th in the nation in receiving yards. Wildcats show blitz. Flores runs it right up the middle, and he's got a first down.
Flores, close.
Nico Flores providing a spark here for the Spartans.
Probably the best life they've shown all evening long. Can they continue the momentum? Can they capitalize on the drive by punching it in?
Boyce now at the bottom of your screen, empty backfield. Flores.
No.
Wanted Boyce in a double coverage, and it was tipped and nearly picked off.
That was one there where they baited Flores into that throw right there. They made him think he had one-on-one, but you're going to see the tap there. They've got him bracket. One underneath, one coming from the inside. There's nowhere to go with that football. Find somebody else to beat me. Give credit to the defense. They're going to make adjustments, too, when they know you want to try and force-feed somebody.
Chris Wally back in the game, and it seemed on that last play that Flores just locked in on Boyce and wasn't looking anywhere else.
Yeah, and the defense made the call. You can tell they did the simple bracket coverage call. Easy to read, easy to pick up for everybody except Flores.
Play clock winding down, and Norfolk State has to burn its final timeout of the fourth quarter and of the second half. So they're out of timeouts with 2:27 to play.
And with that being the case, that means this is four down territory. So that changes your play selection. You've got second and 10. You don't have to pick it all up right now. Within the next two plays, you've got three plays to go out there and keep this drive alive to win this football game.
For Bethune Cookman, if they can hang on, all of a sudden you get a little Lloyd Christmas in you. So you're saying there's a chance. Still probably a long shot for the Wildcats, but all of a sudden they move up in the MEAC standings, and they got a chance, maybe if not winning the conference, of maybe getting a bit of the postseason. For Norfolk State, they get North Carolina A&T next week, so they still have that game to maybe cushion a blow if they fall and they lose this game.
A lot of teams have to play each other. I think the two preseason favorites no longer have to play each other. They're now in the trail position.
Austin left.
All right, Jay, second and 10. They got Wally in the game. What do you call?
Well, I can tell you what they call. They call the X receiver, and that's Xavier Boyce. He plays that X for them. So they're trying to see if they can get him in some type of one-on-one matchup with the mismatch.
That's a run play. That's Akeem Hedgman. Haven't heard much of him here in the second half. He gets four. Third down and six. Jay, as you mentioned, you said this is four down territory?
It's four down. You can tell by that play selection there on second and 10. They run the ball. They just want to try and chip away one first down at a time.
Xavier Boyce wasn't in the game on that last play. He's back in bottom of your screen. Wally to Garrett. Slips one defender, dives forward, and he looks to have the first down. 6 yards on the play.
Wow, if Garrett would have been able to keep his footing, that could have been a big game. Instead, it seems as if he got just enough yards to pick up that first down.
They are going to measure. Garrett was a guy really emerged toward the end of last year, averaged 90 receiving yards per game over the final five games. And he's been in the rotation this year. First down, Norfolk State. This has been their second best drive of the second half. That first drive led to a field goal, 10 plays, 41 yards. This one, so far, they got to get points to make it count. But 7 plays, 66 yards, started at their own 18. Remember, this is a Spartan team whose only loss came to an FBS team in West Virginia. They're undefeated in the MEAC and the FCS.
When teams focus on Boyce, they like to go to Victor Harrison in your slot.
They'll go to Hedgman, and he doesn't have much room trying to operate into the interior of that Wildcat defense.
They continue to try to pound that football against a defense that's just stout in terms of the running game.
Remember, Norfolk State out of timeouts as we come up on 110 to play. Wally throwing for Boyce, and he hauls it in on the far sideline. It's going to be first and goal. A gain of 11 yards, and all of a sudden, the Spartans have a chance.
Yeah, there was plenty of contact here, but that's what we talked about, the frame. 6 feet, 4 inches. He's held right there, but watch him extend. That looks just like Chris Carter used to do. Chris Carter didn't need a lot of separation in order to come down with the ball, but if he kept it close, he'd come down with it.
Less than a minute to play. Now that last play is under review. Was he in bounds? There's the catch.
You only need one in college football.
Tough to see from that angle. Appears that foot is in bounds.
Man, it's gonna be a good night before I get to the house.
There was a route with the out route. Good job, a lot of push in there, good concentration. Caught it cleanly. I think that may come down to it. He was able to catch the ball cleanly, put it away early. But unless you can clearly show that his foot was out of bounds, I think this is going to have to remain a catch.
Tough to tell from any of those angles. Now, was that foot out of bounds when he made the catch? Was that on the line? That's the question.
And if that's the best angle you've got, I don't believe that's enough to overturn it, to say it's indisputable.
It's tough to tell. Six catches, 76 yards for Boyce, if that last call stands. And he had been absent all game. They threw him the deep ball, and you could tell he kind of sprang to life after that.
He did. He got it going. And if you're Norfolk State, think about not having some of those timeouts that you might have said they wasted unnecessarily.
Well, this is a big review. If the play stands, Norfolk State's looking at first and goal, and then you say, hey, 57 seconds left, that's plenty of time. First and goal, you've got four downs. If it's ruled incomplete, now you're looking at third down.
Yeah, and 57 seconds is a lot of time, but not if you plan on running the football. You know, and the threat has been, do you want to rely on just four state throws? I would if I had voice and give an opportunity.
Again, for Norfolk State, they can come back and win this game. They'd still be unbeaten in the MEAC. And all of a sudden, you're looking at a team that's clearly the team to beat in the conference. Bethune-Cookman trying to get back in the race. But a lot of this hinges on this call. Ruling on the field again was a catch.
Good thing he's got on white shoes.
The calling on Bill is confirmed. Completed catch.
It's got to be conclusive to overturn it. So Brian Jenkins, now a watch. But remember, down eight, Norfolk State not only needs a touchdown, they need that two-point conversion. So it's a two-step process here. But it's first and goal, ball on the 4 yard line. Two tight ends for the Spartans. Boyce, the slot receiver, toward the bottom of your screen. Wally throws it up for Boyce, and it's picked off. Intercepted in the end zone by Deion Hanks. And that should seal it for the Wildcats.
They got the one-on-one matchup that they wanted. But Hanks made a great job of coming underneath Boyce. Boyce is swimming. He's got outside leverage. He's trying to stop his feet, but Hanks was able to change directions a little bit quicker than the much taller Boyce. And what a good job by Deion Hanks keeping the Wildcats season alive.
Xavier Boyce is 6'4", 220. Deion Hanks probably listed generously at 5'10", 190. And he takes that ball away from Boyce. Third Norfolk State turnover of the game. And that was the death knell. The Wildcats take the knee. They'll have to take one more. And Bethune-Cookman. A big road win for Brian Jenkins' club.
Give credit to the Wildcats. Not an easy road trip to make, coming from Florida up to Norfolk, but they came here on a mission, and they really took care of their business.
Norfolk State, offensively, just could not move the ball, really, until that last drive, which ended up resulting in an interception. Under 250 yards of total offense. Credit Bethune-Cookman's defense, especially that front four and front seven, really.
And if you take away that last drive, this is a Bethune defense that held Norfolk State less than 200 yards of total offense, not just running or throwing, total offense, dominating defensive performance by Brian Jenkins' Wildcats.
And Bethune-Cookman, they still got a chance in this MEAC race. Now 2-2 in conference. Norfolk State loses for the first time in league play this season. Their five-game win streak is over. And now Norfolk State gets North Carolina A&T next week in a big game that could still decide who wins the MEAC. But Bethune has positioned itself a lot better, and they're in a lot better spot than they were a couple of weeks ago.
Yeah, this was a must-win game with three losses. It's pretty safe to assume that their season would have been done. They come away with the victory. They're still in it. And that's all you want at this point in the season, is to not be mathematically eliminated. And the Wildcats still have a chance, still have a slim chance to hold on to their MEAC championship.
14-6, your final score here in Norfolk. It's time now for the Lexus HBCU postgame report. The Wildcats, they get the win. They're now 2-2 in conference play, 4-3 overall. They've won two straight at Norfolk State. Loses to an FCS school for the first time. Their only other loss up until this point had been to FBS West Virginia. Two keys for Bethune-Cookman. They did it on the ground with Isidore Jackson, more than 200 yards. And then Ryan Davis was just disruptive defensively for the Wildcats.
And for those people that don't know Bethune-Cookman football, you think because they're from Florida, they just rely on speed. They're a lot stronger than their opponents seem to think, and it takes them a while to figure it out. Isidore Jackson, the running back, of course he's got the speed, but he's also got the strength in his legs and the ability to finish off runs. He's very difficult to bring down, low center of gravity. He gets it done. Then you talk about defense. Ryan Davis was the best football player on the field tonight, offensively and defensively. Your prototypical defensive end, high motor, high energy, high impact guy. They're stronger than people think.
Ryan Davis, 6 tackles for losses, 3.5 sacks. Isidore Jackson, more than 200 yards on the ground. Going into this game, Jay, we wondered about Bethune-Cookman. They'd been changing quarterbacks, and you wondered maybe what effect that would have on the locker room. We wondered who the quarterback was going to be before it all started, but they had a game plan. They stuck to it. It was running the football, get pressure on Chris Wally, and they executed it.
Yeah, and they're starting to take on the identity of their coach, Brian Jenkins. He's a grinder, hard-nosed, tough-nosed, playing power football from the spread offense. Sounds like an oxymoron, but they pulled it off.
That does it from Norfolk. Final score, Bethune-Cookman 14, Norfolk State 6. For Jay Walker, I'm Adi Shroff. Let's get you to SportsCenter U and Dari Noka.